Wendy Archer, the Sabi San today. Now, my name is Taylor, and I've been blessed to have the presence of Brian and the thumb this afternoon. What is the thumb today?
The thumb was tired. He's here, but he'll be only in the
main show. So we're not seeing him yet. That's normal. We're not allowed to see the thumb before the show. I just got a sneak peek of him and he's looking fantastic. Now, like I said, it's windy out here today. And this is the pre-drive, my highlight of the entire show. Because we can do all sorts of crazy things that we're not supposed to do in the main part. But sometimes we do them anyway. Now, our plan this afternoon is to go to Artuza. To go and have a look and see humans getting spot. Well, actually, I'm not sure what's been happening this morning, so we'll have to go and investigate and see what's lurking about. Maybe a spotted cat or two. James says he wants to find all the leopards today. I don't know how many leopards that entails, but he wants to see all of them. And I must tell you, I don't know if it is right, but Geraldine said that today is International Brothers Day. So I just want to send a little shout out to my little brother, Sean, aka Cynthia. I said that out loud. Payback, Sean, for sending in the most ridiculous questions. And my older brother, who lives in Australia, happy Brothers Day, mate. Or Ryan, my older brother. And Brian, we'll do your shout out.
I want to do a shout out.
Yes, International Brothers Day.
Yeah, I'll shout out to my brother as well.
What's his name?
Adrian.
Hi, Adrian.
Hi, Adrian, all the way in Germany.
Ooh, wunderbar.
Wunderbar.
As you can see, it's probably going to be one of those ridiculous afternoons, Archer, but that's okay. It's a Friday, it's the weekend. I'm sure everyone's so excited to go on holiday. Maybe you're going on holiday, maybe you're traveling. If you are traveling, travel safe. And we'll just have a fantastic time. But remember, if you want to subscribe so you never miss a live safari, you can click on the YouTube link. I think it's the shape of a bell, and you'll get a notification every time we go live. I think that's quite wonderful, because I'm terrible at remembering. Oh, you have to click subscribe and the bell. There was Louise feeding information into my ear. We have to do all those things, and then you will get notifications and all sorts of wonderful, wonderful goodies. Brian, have you seen anything yet this afternoon? Me neither. I can't see with my sunglasses on anymore. It's got a bit dark. Take those off. I don't think we're going to have much of a sunset tonight, which is quite sad. The clouds are getting very dark. There was rumbling in the distance earlier. I must say, though, at about 2 o'clock this afternoon, maybe half past 2, I came racing outside because I thought I heard so much thunder, and it wasn't. It was James playing Pirates of the Caribbean music. It was so loud that I thought that the storm was on its way and the heavens were about to open. But no, that's not the case. James just got quite excited, and my hat is going to blow off today, I suspect. I'll just have to make it a lot tighter. There's James, look. Hi, James. Let's see what he's doing. Oh, there's an eagle flying around. Bye-bye. I don't think he knows he's been spotted yet. We're watching him as he sneaks around the bush. He's waving. Hi, James. Look at him doing his little creepy wave. I must tell you as well, we had the Christmas party last night, our staff Christmas party, and it was so much fun. We work with the most ridiculous people in the whole world, but somehow it all comes together and it's such an amazing team. But it was very interesting. And I'm going to start wearing reindeer ears.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody, especially to all of you from Glenwood Three Oaks, Salem and Strawbridge Elementary Schools. It's wonderful to have you with us. This is Safari Life.
Ready.
Standing by.
Windy, ooh, ominous afternoon here, and we're talking to you live from South Africa. Now that's at the southern tip of the African continent, and this little piece of the drive, of course, is dedicated to you, the kids of those four, which I remembered and now have subsequently forgotten, and it'll be lovely to have you with us for the next 45 minutes or so. Lovely to have your questions, so any questions you want to ask, send them through, and for the rest of you, of course, once the school drive is finished, hashtag questions at wildearth.tv is the best way to get hold of you. Us, not you. My name is James Hendry. On camera today, making his debut, is Rian. That's Rian's, diving fingers, I suppose. And then on the other vehicle, Taylor McCarty is driving around with Brian the Thumb Joubert, and Brent Leo Smith finds himself walking around. Now, we're going to keep moving, and the reason we're going to keep moving is that I'm a little worried of this weather. We're not going to be going too far from home. Ooh, in fact, there's a bird up there. Rian, can you see it? It's on the right-hand side. Well spotted. That is a lesser-spotted eagle, everyone. How on earth do I know it's a lesser-spotted eagle, you're asking yourself, when all I can see is its head? The answer is that I actually saw it fly up there. And I didn't see where it had landed, but I did see it fly, and it's got a very distinctive pattern on its legs there, and that makes it easy to identify. Now, he's about, he's probably about almost 2 feet long, and what he likes to eat, everyone, is termites. Yes, that's what I said. Termites. So he's been looking at the ground. In fact, we saw him fly off the ground, and he's been trying to get hold of some termites on the ground. Because termites, although you and I would think, ugh, that's disgusting to eat, they're actually pretty good to eat. They taste a little bit like peanut butter. And who doesn't like peanut butter? Isn't he nice? He's a very cool little eagle. Not the biggest that we get here. The biggest we get is called a Marshall eagle, and he's almost 3 feet tall. And that, everyone, is the lesser spotted eagle. All right, let's carry on and see what else we can see. We've got some other birds. You know, we've come down here to try and find the tracks of a leopard, because there were two little leopards around here 2 days ago, but we might not be lucky. Anyway, Brent Leo Smith is about to have his bottom bitten.
As you can see, the wind is rolling in. There's an incredibly strong wind, and we're in big debate about whether it's going to rain or not. My name is Brent. I've got the incredible Vim on camera with me today. Now, I was really hoping to do some butterflies. I even brought my butterfly checklist. I bought a pen, and then the wind came. And we have seen a few butterflies, but at the moment they take off, they are swept away by this gusting wind. We will try, but I think we might have to hold on to that. So this is quite nice. It's a little checklist of the common butterflies of the Lowveld and Kruger region, and hopefully this summer season we're going to be able to work through and maybe even, dare I say, fill. I doubt we'll fill it, but we're going to do our best to work through the butterflies, see how many we can get on camera. As we go along, of course, we have Herbie wandering on the peripheries, making sure we are safe. And of course, bushwalk in weather like this is a bit of a different game. You definitely have to be a lot more focused, and you have to pay a lot more attention. This wind affects your hearing, so you don't want to stumble into something new ground, and you never know what we find. So remember, if you want to send any questions, use the hashtag Safari Live, or you can pop us an email on questions@wildearth.tv. Now, before I get blown off the Termiteria, let us continue. Now, we do get questions like this from time to time, and this one is from Eli, who says, are we actually live? Welcome to Safari. First time. Send me more questions. I'd love to hear from you again, Eli. We are 100% live, and I'm in the middle of the African bush in a wonderful area called the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, which is part of the Greater Kruger National Park. 8.5 million acres of unfenced wilderness that's there for all the animals. And of course, we're animals as well, so it's there for us, so we can enjoy our time with these incredible creatures. Now, before we disappear, Vim, before it gets blown away by the wind. Here we go, our first butterfly on the list. It is feeding on a large devil thorn, a very brave butterfly facing this blustering wind. And that will be our first tick on our list as we go through. It is indeed one we have seen many times before, but it is still a wonderfully beautiful little butterfly. It is called a broad-banded grass yellow. I do like butterflies, and the amazing thing is, because we only get to see some of these butterflies over the summer months, we can get a bit rusty. So there we go. Broad-banded grass yellow, white box for ticking. Tick! Number one. I'm impressed. Feisty wind. But now, let me send you back on board with James Henry, who's got one of our smallest antelope species.
Indeed, not only just one of our smaller, but the smallest antelope that we have here. That's a little male, and he's called a steenbok. Ooh, and you can see he's quite nervous. And he only stands about 1.5 feet tall at the shoulder. So he's not very tall at all. And of course the reason he's so nervous, everybody, is, well, because he's so very small. Just like you, I suppose, you might also be quite nervous if you were so small in a place full of predators. Hello, Emerson. What a very good question from you. You say, how are we able to identify animals so easily? Well, Emerson, it's the same reason that when you first started at school, you didn't know the name of anyone in your class, did you? And you struggled perhaps to recognize them. But after 1 or 2 weeks, you knew everyone's name. You probably knew who had brothers and who had sisters, and you know where everyone lived. And that's just because you had spent time around those people. Now, it's the same thing with us out here. We've spent time around all these animals and all these trees and all these birds, and that makes it easy for us to understand what they are. But it's only through time and through practice that these sorts of things are able to be done. So in the same way that you recognize all the people in your classroom, so it is that we recognize the animals and the birds and the trees that are out here. It's a good question, that. Because I know that this can look very, very similar. Hello, John. I'm going to answer two questions, even though you've only asked me one. You said, what is the strongest deer in Africa? John, there are no deer in Africa. That was not a deer. That was an antelope. An antelope is different from a deer. Remember, I'm sure that you realize now, especially with Christmas coming up, that deer have antlers, and antlers fall off every year, and then they get grown back again by the big males. Now, these are horns. Those antelope have got horns. Horns, much like a cow's, don't fall off at all. And so it's very different, and that's the major difference between a deer and an antelope. We don't get deer in Africa at all. But the strongest antelope we have, or the biggest antelope we have, is something called an eland. An eland. And an eland is about, well, it weighs probably close on 1,000 pounds. So very, very big indeed. Then, of course, we have a buffalo. And our buffalo weigh about 2,000 pounds, so they're enormous animals, very strong indeed. But strictly speaking, we don't get any kinds of deer here at all in Africa. Ah, now Emily, you've asked a very good question, and it's because we are looking perhaps for those very animals. You say, what are the predators of the antelope? Well, out here, we've got lions, sometimes. We've got leopards and cheetahs and wild dogs and hyenas, spotted hyenas. Those are the animals that are most likely to be the ones that eat the antelope and try and catch them. And that's what we're trying to do right now. We're trying to see if we can't find some leopards, because there were some young leopards seen around here just a few days ago. And so we're looking to see if they've left some footprints on the ground, or maybe they're sitting up in a tree. So every time we go past a tree, make sure to look in the top of it. And also, not too far from here, we saw a female leopard and a new male, or a male leopard, and they're trying to make new tiny baby leopards. So that's quite exciting. We might have some baby leopards very soon. As I was saying, it's very windy out here. Ooh, look at that big bird up there in the sky. And it's being chased by a much smaller bird. You see that? I'm just trying my binoculars to see what kind of big bird that is. It's an eagle. I think it's what we call a Wahlberg's eagle. And the way I know that is because it's got a thin tail. Isn't that bird brave? That little bird is saying, go away, go away. I don't want you anywhere near where I live, because you'll probably try and kill my babies. And that's why that's going on there. Isn't that cool? That's very cool. Okay, let's carry on from here. Right, now my friend Taylor has got some special kinds of sort of ducks, and they look like they come from North Africa.
We are looking at a pair of Egyptian geese as one of them grazes, and it seems as though the other one is keeping a close eye on us this afternoon. Isn't that lovely? Beautifully done up makeup on one of the few birds that look like they've got a bit of makeup around their face. It's not really makeup, of course, it's just beautiful markings. And then, of course, the other one that I quite like is the red-backed shrike with the black stripe going right over their eye, or their eyes, because I suppose it goes over both of them. Aren't these lovely birds? Now, I'm sure you're probably wondering who I am. I suppose I better very quickly introduce myself. So, my name is, of course, Taylor, and on camera with me, we've got Brian, but I've got to introduce you to his very special friend. Can you see that? A lovely thumb. What is the thumb today?
Just a face.
Just a face. Just a face thumb this afternoon. That's all right. Hello. Okay. Well, so I believe, Michaela, you're wondering, how much do we feed our animals every day? I've got something to tell you. We're so lucky. They're all completely wild. So, oh, animals do we see? Sorry, Louise. I was introducing myself. I got that completely wrong. Not how many do we feed, how many do we see? Well, at the moment, unfortunately, it's been a little bit quiet out in the bush. Sometimes this happens when you have lots of rain. And that, of course, brings a lot of different types of food around. So the animals all move away. And they go to different areas. They don't have to move around in big groups looking for food. It's everywhere at the moment, which is really, really nice. So it depends. It's been a bit slow, only a couple of mammals, but sometimes we get to see leopards, lions, cheetah, all the different types of birds, mongoose, and all sorts of other things, and lots of antelope like impala and kudu. So some days you can see 20 different animals, some days you can see 50 different animals, and on a very quiet day, sometimes you can only see five, or maybe even nothing. That sometimes happens too, but that's the way that it goes. But now we have popped onto an area called Arethusa, and well, oh, what's happening down here? Can you see that, Brian? These three little birds? It looks like that is a sandpiper. It looks like a wood sandpiper on the left, And then you can see that there's another bird on the right-hand side of your screen. That is a three-banded plover. And there was another one as well. And I think the pair of the three-banded plovers were actually chasing the sandpiper away. Look at it. Look. Oh! See? Saying, no, no, this is my area. Oh, my goodness. You are very feisty for such a small bird. That bird is probably the size of your fist. If you curl it up into a ball, you bring all your fingers close together. That is how big that bird is. It is tiny. It's really small. And that sandpiper is probably double that size. Ooh, it's going again. Now watch this sandpiper try and make a move. Oh no! Off it goes, being chased away. And that's most likely the male, the plover that's chasing the sandpiper around. Look how fast he goes. Colin, I'll answer your question in just a moment. That poor little bird is also just trying to have its share at this beautiful big watering hole at Red Dam. And it's not getting up. It's quite persistent, eh, Brian? Naughty little birds. And this is quite typical. Possibly they're competing for the same food source, but I suspect that that sandpiper will be all right now that it, of course, has moved to the other end of the dam. It's given that feisty three-banded plover a gap. Right. So we're on Arethusa. We're going to go and see if the lions have perhaps popped across. Now, Colin, you were wondering if we see any migrating birds because we're so lucky to have such a nice temperature here. You're quite correct. We see a variety of different birds. Let me just turn the game drive radio down very quickly. And some of them that come all the way from Russia, for example, the steppe buzzard or the stepped eagle, they come all the way from the Russia and come down here for our summer. And then a lot of birds, what happens to them in South Africa is they come to South Africa in our summer months and they sort of move from the northern sectors in Africa. And the reason why they come down here is because in North Africa it gets terribly hot and it's almost unbearable at times. So I think it's a lot more pleasant for them to come down this way and breed down here. Though we get a couple of birds, some of the bee eaters and things, that not all of them breed down here. They just come, they're just sort of visitors and just come around. Maybe a change of diet and all those types of things. But we see lots and lots of different birds. We might even see some of those birds today, Colin. So we'll keep an eye out and hopefully we will show you. Now, I'm so sorry. My comms are not fantastic in being able to communicate. But I think Louise says that we're going to shoot on back across to Brent and see what he's up to.
What are you starting on? Now, Vim and I have found something fascinating. It's a reptile egg. Now, I'm not sure whether it's a snake or possibly a plated lizard. I'm leaning towards snake. Now, I've been debating with myself. Are we going to open it or are we going to keep it intact? But my curiosity has got the better of me. So we're going to try very delicately open it because I can hear something inside. So I'm really fascinated to see. We might possibly have a perfect little skeleton in this unopened egg, and I'd love to know what it is. So I'm going to try very delicately, just saw the top off. It's very brittle. Now I can't see whether it's a snake. What is it? What are you? Bones, come out. Oh, let's have a look. There we go. I'm going to try to get them out now. And Xavier, indeed we do have lots of snakes. Xavier was wondering whether we get any snakes in South Africa. We have a lot of different species, including the black mamba. Vim's going to shine a torch in there. Can you see what it is, Vim?
I just tilt it down a bit. Can't really see.
Can't really see. This is so fascinating. Now we're trying to see whether it's a little snake. Of course, it might not have formed at all just yet. I'm going to be very careful now. Okay. Time to use another tool. I can't really see what it is. Oh, this is so delicate. I don't want to break it. Oh, I couldn't imagine what a stress a doctor must go through if I'm feeling this, just trying to remove a tiny little artifact. Oh no, I can't grip it. It keeps falling down. Hello, Strawbridge third graders. They'd like to know if any dangerous animals ever come very close to people. And they do. I think I've nearly got it now. Oh, I'm trying to see if there's a head or something. And it's. I just don't want to break it. Whatever is in here. Come on! Yeah, this is turning into quite the palaver. Come on, concentrate now. This is really old. I mean, there's no smell. It's a very earthy smell almost. And I think whatever's left has become almost like soil. So every time I try to grab it, it disintegrates a little bit. See, that's all I'm getting is like powdered bone in here. I just want to see if there's a head on it. Okay. See what I mean? It's become sort of just like powdered bone, whatever it is. I mean, there's no smell on it whatsoever. Let's see if we can get any more out. Oh dear. Deary, deary me. This is such a mystery. Now, what's probably happened is this is a dead egg, so it wasn't fertilized, and I don't think it even started forming into whatever adult thing it was going to become. And I think it's just what we're dealing with here is, ooh, thunder in the background. There we go. Yeah, see, I mean, ooh, it hasn't, I think it has, oh dear, no, come back. I mean, I can't see any head. I don't think it's formed into anything, but just based on the shape of the shell, I think it was a snake that never came to be. Poor little snakey. Well, let's put that back in. I'm going to take this back for our collection of stuff in our tent. Let's put it over there for now. Hi, Jonathan. Jonathan is wondering if we get pythons here and how big do they get. Well, Jonathan, we do. The biggest python I've seen in South Africa is 6 meters long, and that is about, I'm gonna just step it out for you. So let's pretend that is the head. I'm gonna guess, and I'm gonna walk towards you to show you how big it is. What do you reckon? I think that's probably about 6 meters, maybe. So let's go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that's how long they are. Isn't that absolutely massive? And they can weigh more than that. Sorry, I'm trying to do my conversion. Probably around 300 to 350 pounds, a really big python like that. It is incredible how large they are. Now, while we've been sitting here dissecting our egg, we have been watched by a herd of impala. Isn't that wonderful? The most numerous antelope south of the Sahara. And not only are there impala out here, if we go that way now, we can see a lovely little herd of zebra. Now, I've got a question for you guys out there. Are zebra black with white stripes or white with black stripes? What do you think? Are zebra black with white stripes or white with black stripes? Why don't you let me know, and I'll tell you the answer a little later. Okay, we're gonna keep on moving from here, but we've taken the pack off to so we could get nice and close while I was trying to delicately open that snake egg. So VM's got to pop it back on his back, and then we're going to carry on walking. I'm hoping we're going to find some more amazing things while we're here. And wait, my Herbie has pointed to something. What have you seen, Herb? Underneath that. Herb has got a surprise. There's something underneath. And it's going to bite me, Herbie. I don't know what it is, so. Where's it gone? What is there, Herb? I don't know what this is. This is a cryptic game. Well, maybe it's escaped. But Herbie's found something. We're not sure what it is. Is it going to bite me if I put my fingers there? Yes, it's going to bite me, which probably means it's a scorpion or a centipede or some other nasty. Okay, let's just be careful. I think it's just run away, Herbie. It escaped us. But anyway, we're going to keep moving. Hopefully this fearful creature has not crawled up VM's pants while we've been down here. So while we do that, we're going to go across to James, who's driving around.
I'm not driving around. I've stopped everyone. And there is a very special animal called a vervet monkey. And those are tiny little baby vervet monkeys that are playing with a big female monkey, a big mother monkey. And the interesting thing about what we're seeing here, you know, is that we saw them being chased across the road by an impala. Now, that's a very strange thing for an impala to be doing, of course. But I think that what was happening is that the female impala was running away from a male who was being very nasty to her, and that just made the monkeys run. So that's what's going on there. And they're sitting in a tree that you wouldn't want to sit in at all. It's full of nasty thorns, vicious thorns. And monkeys are just much tougher than we are, you know, so that they can sit in those thorns and they don't have to worry too much about it at all. They're absolutely fine. Anyway, that is the vervet monkey. Now remember, it's not a velvet monkey, it's a vervet monkey. Well, there we are, John. You were asking a question about what kind of animal is an omnivore. Well, the monkeys are omnivores to a certain extent. I'm just going to turn the car slightly, but a better example of an omnivore, I suppose, would be a baboon. Now, a baboon is like a monkey, just much bigger. And Rian, they're jumping into the tree just over there and having a bit of a play fight. There we go. That's it. And then the other obvious omnivore, John, is something called a bush pig. It's like a sort of wild pig, and they like to eat meat and vegetables and fruit, a bit like you. Monkeys eat a little bit of meat, so largely these monkeys here will eat insects for meat. They'll eat the odd reptile if they can get it. They can eat eggs, and they will also eat lots of fruit and sometimes flowers and sometimes leaves, and so they eat lots of different kinds of things. See, it's just jumped into that tree that's so full of thorns, you and I wouldn't even touch that tree, you know. Look at the big female at the top there, just scratching herself, just like you think you've seen monkeys do, I suppose, in some cartoons. There's another one coming now from the right-hand side, about to jump onto the tree. There it is. Now, he's sitting on a tree that doesn't have any thorns on it, so that's nice. Rian, right over here, close by, there's another monkey. You see it there? There we go. Now, this tells us something very important. The fact that the monkey is not scared to come onto the ground tells me that it's quite possible that there are no leopards around here, because monkeys will not go on the ground if they think they're going to be eaten. They like the safety of the trees. Hello, Silas. You say, what does that monkey do? Well, Silas, It just lives, basically, out here. It doesn't have a job. It doesn't have to go to school. It doesn't have to do the things, chores around the house. All it has to do all day long, and the same goes for every single other animal out here, is make friends, eat, or try and find enough food to eat, and then go to sleep. And, of course, not be eaten. It's very important because monkeys, of course, can be eaten by very big eagles. They can be eaten by leopards and lions. And they can also, of course, be eaten by very big snakes like pythons. So their job, basically, Silas, is to stay alive. And they do that by finding enough food to eat, which is not always very easy, by watching out for predators, by finding some water, and then making friends. In monkey society, a bit like our own human society, making friends is a very important part of what they do. Because if you live in a group, well, as you well know from your playing on the playground, it's not so nice when you don't have any friends. And so it's important that a monkey makes friends. And you know, sometimes, just like us, you know when you've made a mistake and maybe your friends are a bit cross with you, a bit angry with you, it's exactly the same thing as when your friends are a little bit angry with you. That happens in a monkey troop. And sometimes they get a little bit cross with each other. And so it really is very similar to how we as human beings act. Isn't that a nice picture there of a monkey? You can see just like a human being. It's sitting there, scratching his foot like you might. Now, a very good question from Strawbridge Elementary School, all of you there, saying, what kind of adaptations does a monkey have in order to avoid getting injured by the thorns? Well, it's nothing really specific. They have got very tough hands, in the same way that if you are a human being who works a lot with your hands, let's say that you lay bricks or you chop wood with an axe, you're going to get very hard, what we call calluses on the hand. And that means that your skin will become very tough. And it's basically the same thing. So they don't really have anything particularly special. They've just got very, very tough hands and feet. Now look at that, isn't that wonderful? That's an older monkey helping a younger monkey take the ticks off the body, because there'll be lots of different kinds of ticks, and a tick is a little invertebrate that lives on the fur. Is he eating them off? You all know what a tick is. In the United States, a tick is something that causes Lyme's disease. And there's a similar sort of thing here. So that's what they're being careful of doing with each other. And the reason they do that is to stop each other getting sick and so that they are friendly with each other. So often you'll find that animals who've had a bit of a fight, like I was describing earlier, often you'll find that they will start to groom each other in order to say, you know, I'm sorry. And then somebody else says, oh, I'm sorry too. Let's not fight. And then they're all friends again. Now, we had a very good question coming through, but I'm afraid I've forgotten what it was, so I'm going to ask for it again. Oh, yes. How do monkeys protect themselves? And that's from Griffin. Griffin, they protect themselves by staying in the trees. Look at that tiny little monkey. That monkey can't be more than maybe a month old. Isn't that cute? Griffin, they protect themselves by being very fast. And they live in groups, and all the time that there is one monkey on the ground, or there are a whole lot feeding on the ground, then others will be sitting up very high in the trees looking for predators, and then they make a noise. That's the noise they make when they see a predator, and that helps them to defend themselves against predators. So it's mainly, you know, it's a bit like us when we live out here. We're not very strong compared to the animals out here. We have to use our brains to defend ourselves. So we'll climb into clever places, or we'll see tracks on the ground and avoid certain areas. That's very similar when you happen to be a monkey. Very nice sighting, this, of monkeys. We don't often see them this nicely. We'll just have one last look at them and then we'll carry on and move, because they've made a nice group up there in the middle of the tree on the right-hand side. There we go. A And I know there are lots of sticks and trees in the way, but that's also another way that they protect themselves, by staying in pretty thick areas. So there's no leopard that's going to get up there and manage to catch one of them. All right, let's have one last look at the babies on the left, and then we'll carry on and see what else we can see. There we go. Look at those little ones there. They're only, you know, they're very, very small. They're not even a foot long. And look, they're two friends. They're two young friends. And now one of them's a little bit worried because its mum's gone across to the other tree. Now, that's definitely not the mother. That's an older, probably a brother or a cousin. And see, the little one nearly fell off. See how strong they are? Look, a whole big group of monkeys together. And they're staying warm like that, you see. It's quite chilly suddenly. The wind's blowing very strongly. And because it's blowing through some fairly sort of moisture-laden or very wet clouds, probably some rain further down south, the wind's quite cold. And so those monkeys are staying together to try and stay warm. Alrighty, let's carry on and see what else we can find. That was a very nice sighting. We're very lucky to have seen all of those. Monkeys are not very common out here. Alright, let's go and find out from Taylor. You met the Egyptian geese with her. Let's go and find out what the next treat she has in store for you is.
We're watching a couple of impala dash across the road. Let's see if any of them give us a bit of a jump. And that's what they are renowned for, these incredible antelope, is the fact that they are able to leap huge distances at a full sprint. But it seems as though they didn't feel threatened and they didn't feel the need to bound about this afternoon. But we've got a couple of male impala here. You can see that because they've got the beautiful big horns on top of their heads, of course. The females don't have any horns. Doesn't look like there's any younger boys. We're starting to see the young impala rams from the previous season all being chased out of the breeding herds now and sort of pushed on to join these bachelor groups where they'll live out the next few years, learning how to battle with their horns, eating lots and lots and getting nice and fit. And eventually, and potentially, when they're big and strong enough and able to take out the dominant males, will be able to join a herd of their very own. But they are very, very wary this afternoon with all the wind that we're having. Look at them all disappearing very, very quickly. Wow. Now, the impala are wonderful, but it seems as though Brent has got something more exciting than this. Let's jump across on foot and see what he's got.
Okay, guys, I'm just trying to get it out. Now, I've got to be very careful. Out of all our scorpions here, we've got two that are medically important in terms of danger, and this scorpion is one of them. It's called Europlectes olivaceus. I can't remember its English name offhand. Now, there were two of them here, and the one female has got all her, she's carrying all her babies. Now, she's just gone under this log. Gotta be careful, there could be another one, there could be more. Where's that other one gone? There he is. So there's another one there. Or could be even a third one. Oh, he's gone under the bronc. Okay, now I've lost sight. That's not ever a good thing. Of the female. Oh no, there she is. Watch out, I'm gonna fall. Oops. Okay, now the female has burrowed into this little bit of grass here. And she's trying to hide. I really don't want to get stung by this particular species of scorpion. But this is just an amazing thing. It's not something you get to see too often. So I really want to show you her, but I also don't want to hurt her or disturb her. Where's she gone now? Okay, there she is. Come look, come from the side here, Vim. Look at that. It's a mother scorpion carrying all her babies. Oh, that thing. Oh, jump, Brent, jump. As I said, that sting is incredibly, incredibly painful. And it is one of the scorpion species that certain people do have allergic reactions to the venom. Is she attacking the termite? She is. She's just stung a termite and it's in her pincers. Wow. She's let it go now. I think it was a soldier termite who annoyed her. Now, oh, she's fine. I'm going for cover. Okay, I'm not going to do too much more or for too much longer. Just a little bit. There she is. Oh, and a massive red Roman or solifuge. Now, he hunts scorpions, but he doesn't like being out during the day. As you can see, incredibly quick. Okay, so here she is. This is an absolutely incredible. This is not something you get to see every day. That all the babies on her back. There we go, look at that. Isn't that absolutely amazing? Europlectes olivaceus, an incredibly potent sting. I think it's an 8 out of 10 on the pain scale. She's defending her babies, keeping them on her back. Okay, shame. We're gonna put her. Oh, I'm just gonna put some cover over it so she feels safe. She should stop moving, and it's the same piece of cover she was hiding under earlier. But that was amazing. Now that is not something you see every day. I'm gonna do a little dance. That was so fun. Herbie thankfully found that scorpion for us. There were two of them under that piece of bark. You can see she's now stopped running. She's staying under there. She feels safe. Now she'll only normally come out at night to start hunting. Wow. Hello, Three Oaks. Three Oaks, would like to know, are all scorpions poisonous? No, no scorpions are poisonous. They are venomous. So poison, you have to ingest, so you have to eat it. Venom is injected. So a bee is venomous, a scorpion is venomous, a snake is venomous. Now, all species of scorpion are venomous. They all have the ability to inject venom into you, but there are lots of different types of venom and obviously grades of venom. Now this is the second most potent venom of all the scorpions we get here. There's only one scorpion that is more powerful, and that is much bigger. It's called a Parabethus. And its tail can get to the size of my thumb, and their bodies can get to the size of my hand. And they're actually one of the few scorpion species that is able to spray venom as well if something's attacking it. Now, let's have a look. We don't want to disturb the mom with the babies, but there was another one here on this log. I don't know where it's gone. You gotta always be very careful, of course. Now, if you've got scorpions where you live, I would recommend not picking them up. Now, Three Oaks were wondering why the scorpion was after the termites. Now, the reason it was probably after the termites is because there were soldier termites there and they might pose a threat to her babies. I don't know where the other one's gone. I said you got to be very careful. And there we go. All the deadly things are here today. Vim has spotted a violin spider in that crack. Oh, yes, there we go. Look at that. Now, this is also one of the most venomous spiders we get out here. It's called a violin spider. It has cytotoxic venom, which what means is it is cell destroying venom, and it will make basically your skin cells just die around there. So it causes big holes if you ever get bitten. It's very rare to get bitten. They're actually quite shy spiders, and they generally prefer to avoid conflict with human beings. Now you ought to be very careful, because it looks very similar to the absolute harmless daddy long legs. Now, another interesting question from Strawbridge Elementary about venom. Are there many venomous spiders? All true spiders are venomous. So even a daddy long legs, even though it's harmless, its mouth can't open wide enough to bite you. But all true spiders have venom in their fangs, and it helps with their digestive process and with obviously killing what they catch. Now, that big red thing that we saw scuttle off there, that I called a sun spider or a red Roman, is an arachnid. So it's part of the same family as spiders, but it is not a spider. It is a solarfuge. It's their own family, and they have massive mandibles, and they're able to bite things to death. But they've got no venom glands, and they're unable to produce venom. So that is why it is not a spider. It's a solarfuge. What have you spotted, Herb? Oh, funny looking little bug. Oh, it's a mantid. A beautiful, beautiful praying mantis. And you can see the camouflage it's got for hiding amongst dead wood. Very cool. Hey, little guy. See, there he is right there. I'm just gonna move the, oh, where'd he go? There he is. You can see him running along the ground there. Now, that looks to be a female mantid because of her large, thickened abdomen or bottom section. Now, you really want to be a lady praying mantis, and that's because you definitely don't want to be a boy praying mantis, because when they'll finish making the next generation of praying mantises, the female will eat the male. Now, there's a very important reason for that. What happens is the male sacrifices himself. The male sacrifices himself so the female gets enough nutrients to be able to successfully lay her eggs. Now, we've had such a wonderful time around one of my favorite dead trees on Juma. It's got a scorpions, praying mantises, solarfuge, and we're going to keep moving on, seeing what else we can find. Now, James is with some of the latest additions to the Juma family down next to the Mwati River. Let's go have a look.
Well, there you are, everybody. There, just underneath that big, big, sharp, hardy-dar's beak, is a little baby. Isn't that sweet? There are three of them in this nest, and their mum's just trying to keep them very warm as the wind blows. And look at that nest. Aren't you glad that when you go home this evening, you're going to have a soft bed to lie in? Well, if you're a hardy-dar, you don't get a soft bed to lie in. All you get is that very spiky pile of sticks to sleep in. I wouldn't like to be a hardy-dar baby. Some birds build lovely nests that are lined with feathers and soft, silky spider web and sometimes some leaves. Not the hardy-dar and most of the eagles. They have got a very sort of spiky nest of sticks and twigs with thorns in it. I guess that helps them to leave home a little bit earlier. All right, chaps from Glenwood, Three Oaks, Strawbridge and Salem Elementary Schools, that's going to be it from us today. We're going to carry on our safari. You're going to carry on your school day. I hope you have a good day at school there today and that you will be back on safari with us very soon. And I think that's the end of the school drive. Now, Brent is still with the scorpion and the babies, and I think that's something definitely worth going to have another look for. We're going to keep looking for tracks of the leopards along here. Haven't found anything as yet, but we'll keep you posted. Let's go back to the baby scorpions.
That female scorpion came out on the hunt, stung a termite and then ate it. Now I'm just trying to hope she moves through again. So she's all of a sudden come out and started hunting. She's going underneath this log though. And I said, I don't want to disturb her because, come around, Vim. She's on the move, she's on the hunt. She's about to disappear now. So she caught and stung a termite and then ate it. Uh
is absolutely amazing. I mean, keeping all those babies safe on her back. And that's a very, very big olivaceous. I still can't remember what its common name is. I'm going to have to scratch my brain. Maybe James or Taylor can remember what its English name is. But I think we're going to leave her be. I might definitely come back and check this area again on Bushwalk at some point to see what we can find. Now, we found all those scorpions and stuff because we came, as I said, to one of my favorite dead trees on Juma. Now, in December last year, there were these awesome elephant bulls that were hanging around quarantine when this tree fell over, and it caused a lot of fun for us and for the Eddies because they just fed on it. Now, they did not push it over. This tree's too big for them to push over. But what's happened is, you can see here, there's bark and here. And what happened, and they didn't debark the whole tree. They just debarked the side. And what that did was give access to the wood borers. The longhorn family and click beetle family are all wood boring beetles. And there you can see these massive wood borers have now gone in, and they basically ate the section that was exposed by the elephants. And what that did was then compromise the strength of the tree. So even this tree was alive when it fell down, even though there was only a very narrow bit of bark that was bringing nutrients. And you can see, when I mean it compromised the strength, it basically turned the hard heart part of the tree into a honeycomb, basically. So it lost all its structural integrity, and then a strong wind pushed it over. Now, if you look carefully in these things here, now let me see. Okay, yes, VM, see all this here. Now, this is actually wood borer larvae excrement. So it's almost like cement, but this is basically all the wood that's been chewed by them and then defecated out. And they actually use it to plug their holes to try and stop predators like birds and stuff getting access to them. Now, this particular, these really, really big holes, like the one we showed you earlier, belong to the giant longhorn beetle. And as Herbie knows, I got taught by a great man, a great tracker, by the name of Renius Mklongo, who told me these things were the business. And they're basically big, as thick as my thumb, about long, big white grubs, but they taste like bacon. They are delicious. You fry them a little bit, they are so good, but I think quite a few people struggle to eat them because they do taste like bacon, but they have the consistency of snot. So when you bite into them, it's a very good tasting. It's like liquefied bacon. Okay, moving on from our wonderful dead marula tree. We're going to keep cruising across quarantine. Hopefully, we're going to find some more amazing stuff while we do that. Taylor is with some more new additions to the Juma family, but will they last out the year? We're going to have to wait and see.
We've stumbled across a herd of impala that surprisingly, well, I was just about to say that wasn't running away from us, but it seems as though they've changed their minds this afternoon. You can see them darting across your screen. It was quite a big herd too, but we need to reverse anyway, and the reason for that is because Brian and I spotted some vultures flying up from the distance. So I'd like to go back to where we saw them coming from and see what we can find, and I think we'll get a nice view of these impala as well. So we'll try and have another look. It's going to reverse. Now, it's as much as Brian and I are appreciating the wind. See, there's another vulture going. Now, I know it's going to be difficult for you to see because it's gone into the distance, but they're all flying around with massive crops. They're all nice and full. So I wonder what they've been feeding on. Let's go and have a look. What do you think, Brian? We're uncertain. It could be a number of different things. It could be something that's died of natural causes, and perhaps the vultures stumbled across it. Maybe something has killed something. I don't know, but we'll have to go and have a look. But before we do that, hello guys. Oh, don't run away, please don't run away. And they're running away. Oh, but those lambs are so precious. They are so tiny, and it is so funny to watch them when they get a burst of energy and they sort of go racing away. And also the little sounds that they let off constantly. Keep communicating with their moms and, well, the other little youngsters. And it's nice to see them as they're growing up. They're sort of getting a little bit of independence now. They're not just sticking to the sides of their mother. Ooh, did you hear that? There is some thunder rumbling. It might be a little bit too far in the distance. Sorry, so as I was saying, what we're going to start to see now, and I've seen it a couple of times, not too often though, is where you get the little ones all joining up and almost forming a creche, like a little play school, where they're being watched closely by one female, and the little ones all get an opportunity to play around. And of course they're able to do that with the protection of this beautiful big male impala that we are looking at. He must be very, very proud. Whether he was the one that mated with all the females, I'm not sure. Not very brave though, in this weather with all the wind. And I don't blame them. Imagine if you were stranded out in an area. Well, I shouldn't say stranded, because they wouldn't know where else they could be. But in the middle of Africa, you know that there are all sorts of predators out here that are constantly looking for something to eat. And all of a sudden, you've got this gusting wind and you can't hear anything now, which is the sense that you rely on most. And of course, your eyesight, and that's all you're relying on. Imagine how frightening that must be. We're gonna head on over to where we saw these vultures flying from, and hopefully we'll be able to reveal something. I'm not sure, but we'll go and investigate. But let's go back across to Brent and see what else, well, something else he's got for you, maybe something interesting.
Well, it seems to be all about the scorpions today. Now, here we go, is a very, very active, probably a shining, burrowing scorpion's hole, Epistothelmus glabrophons, for those who like the Latin. Now, this one has been feasting as well. Can you see the wings inside, Vim? Let me just do this. You can tell what he's been eating, one of his favorite foods. There we go. They are the wings of a termite alate, a future king or queen. Let's take them out a bit more. I'm sure the wind will blow them. There we go. So this is a very active hole. And the reason we can see this, you can see the different colored dirt here all around. So he's been spring cleaning, kicking out all this dirt. You can see it's a darker color. It was probably because of the rain, washed a bit down there. Now, this is the lucky one. And the reason I say this is the lucky one is because I look over here and I go, oh dear, what happened here? Someone was after a scorpion. And I mean, you can see how deep these holes go. So the shiny burrowing scorpion is one of the deepest living scorpions. It can live up to 2 meters down in the ground in the correct soils, but something has dug it up. And I'm not sure whether that, whatever dug that up, was successful, but he didn't go far, or she didn't go far, before she had a successful dig. Now I'm going to let you guys try to decide what creature it was that put an end to the poor Epistothelmus glabrophons. Here we go. That's all that's left of the once resident, proud resident of this hole on quarantine. One pincer. The rest has been snacked on, and I wonder if you know which animal has eaten this
poor scorpion. If you know the answer, please send it through on Twitter using the hashtag SafariLive, or send an email, questions at wildearth.tv. Which creature digs up the scorpions and can dig them up from a great depth and eats them? Now, this was during the rain, so you can't see any tracks, but I know who the critter is who's responsible. I think I'm gonna keep that's quite a nice claw. I think I add it to my collection. Let us carry on. Oh, David, 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 you are far too fast. It indeed was the honey badger, or the rattle. One of, I know, a lot of people's favorite animals. They are incredible, incredible little creatures. Incredibly strong, incredibly tough, not to be tangled with. They are so tough that the South African military named their armored car after them. So the South African military's armored troop carrier is called a rattle, which is another word for a honey badger. So they are incredible creatures, and we don't see them as often as I would like to see them, but we do see them from time to time. They don't occur in very high densities, and they are quite mobile, but we have been lucky enough to see them a few times. Now, moving on. What else is out here? Now, we're going to keep walking. Taylor has found an animal that we haven't seen too much of recently, so let's go have a look.
We have indeed stumbled across a bizarre scene to see on such a chilly afternoon like we're having today. And of course, that's buffalo wallowing in the mud. Well, one is only really committed to wallowing away, as you can see. The one right at the back with all the oxpeckers flying around. And that buffalo has caused quite a stir because, as you can see, it's got a wound on its rump. As that oxpecker reopens that wound to feed on the blood, which is the biggest problem. But luckily, they don't really do too much damage. When I say problem, that was the wrong word to really use. I've never really seen a wound get so badly infected, or, you know, sort of not being able to heal because of the oxpeckers. So I think it's more of just an irritation, and that wound just keeps festering for a little bit longer. But they were all fighting over it at the just a minute ago. And it seems as though this fellow has won and fended off the others and kept them at bay. Lots of flies hanging around that wound as well. It's just amazing how tough these creatures are, because you see how they wallow in this dirty water. And I always wonder to myself, how on earth do they not die of an infection from something like that? But I suppose that's what makes these animals able to survive out in the wildest areas in Africa, is that you've got to be tough. You've got to be able to survive long, extended periods of drought where there's no food, very little water. And you can see that these gentlemen are slowly recovering. Now we're looking at these buffalo over here, and I don't know, Brian, what do you think? Do you think that buffalo on the right is a female or a male? It's quite hard to tell. It looked like it could be a female, eh? Yes, it looks like a girl just because her horns aren't massive, but it could just be a male with small horns too. It's obviously very difficult to tell as this buffalo is sitting down. It's easier when they stand up. Now, good afternoon, David from Napa. You were wondering who would be the pathfinder in a herd of buffalo. Would it be a male or would it be a female? Well, that's a very interesting question you've asked. And it's actually the females that are the pathfinders. So they get this information passed to them from when they're younger, from their grandmothers, from their mothers, whoever it may be, on all the different routes to use to find the greenest grass at certain times of the year, the dams that are going to be filled with water. And well, for these boys, and well, this one girl is what we think it is at the moment, I don't think they'd really have a pathfinder amongst this small group. I think that they would just sort of be bumbling around and hope to stumble back into another herd of buffalo, and they could join up for safety purposes, of course. But you can really, really see it. And hopefully in the up and coming months, we're going to see the masses of buffalo that come through, the 300 and 400 individuals that will come through. Then you really get to see the pathfinders at work. Here we go, a couple of oxpeckers jumping around. just hanging on, having... Oh, hungry, they are eating. It's amazing how sometimes they're jumping around, feeding on the various ticks and other ectoparasites, and then occasionally they get a little bit cold and sort of huddle up onto the backs of the buffalo trying to get their body heat. Let's see if this boy is going to sit down for us. Hello, big boy. Still looking quite thin though. You can see his hips protruding quite a bit, but he should be all right. Looks like he's going to have a seat again. Oh, look how lovely that is. He's going over to just greet his fellow members. He's multitasking at the moment, as you can see. This buffalo actually doesn't look very well. Now you can see he's defecating at the moment. And the feces of buffalo is normally quite loose. It's not a sort of a thick stool, but you can see that this buffalo has indeed got diarrhea. Now that's not good. When animals get diarrhea, they become dehydrated very, very, very quickly. And now if you look at this buffalo, look at it's definitely a cow now, you can see quite clearly. She's in much better condition. You can't see her hips sticking out. And there's honestly no reason for that male buffalo to look the way he does. There is plenty of grass around, and it's been around for the last few weeks. So he should have recovered. So he's possibly sick. Maybe he's got some internal parasites or something that we don't quite know about. And that is the reason why he is so thin. Now, sorry, Chanel, you asked a question a little bit earlier and you were wondering, how do the buffalo, you always find it amazing how the buffalo are so tolerant of the oxpeckers picking at their wounds. Now, you're quite right in saying that. I also don't know how I would deal, but I must tell you a very quick story. So when I was down in the Eastern Cape, so that's about the southeast corner of South Africa, on the game reserve that I was working on, the oxpeckers in that area were eradicated because of a poison that they were using on dipping all the domestic cattle to prevent ticks and other various ectoparasites. Anyway, it wiped out the entire population of red-billed oxpeckers. They reintroduced them, but now for about, I think it was about 30 years or so, they didn't have any oxpeckers in that area. And when the oxpeckers started to spread and their population started to grow, it was amazing to see how the animals were just not used to them. So they would land on the backs of the giraffe, of the buffalo, the impala, and they would all turn into bucking broncos, trying to sort of kick away and get the birds off of their bodies. It was quite hysterical. And over time, in probably a couple of months or so, we could see a difference on how they were sort of getting used to them. So it was quite amazing. So I think, Chanel, it's really just a time of really getting used to the animals pecking away. And like I said, they're quite tough. But if it does hurt a little bit, you will see the buffalo give a bit of a shake or maybe kick, or you swat its tail to try and chase that bird away if it is, you know, sort of causing a little bit of pain. But most of the time, you see they're quite tolerant of it. And I think it's not too bad. Now, we've got these buffalo, and then we've also got a vulture sitting up on the top of the tree. And remember I said to you earlier that we spotted some vultures flying overhead with very full crops? Now I can't see for the moment. Looks like he's got a very full crop. You can see a little bit of a bulge there, just after the white feathers on the neck. Now I'm not sure exactly what these vultures have been feeding on. I suspect it's something in this drainage line that's out of view for us. But we'll have a keep having a look around here. But while we have a look and hopefully see what these vultures have been feeding on, let's go to James, who has got a steenbok.
Oh no, everybody, we don't have only a steenbok. We have two steenbok, and they seem to be in the stages of a romantic interlude. We might be the very first people in the world to catch steenbok mating live. Yes, that's what I said. Steenbok mating live. They seem absolutely shocked that anyone should want to watch that. I don't really blame them for that, I must confess to you. I do find it slightly voyeuristic that we're so fascinated by animals and their private moments. Anyway, this is fascinating. Let's keep moving. I just want to sneak slightly forward. Oh, no, there they go. That's a pity. Come on. Isn't this fun? I don't know that this has ever been caught on camera. Antelope mating is extremely brief. I've watched Impala doing it every so often, and it takes less than 2 seconds for the mating act to actually occur, and I'm pretty sure it would be the same with Steenbok. Oh well, there it is. Almost caught, and almost therefore I was able to use my very favourite expression, but I can't use it now because, well, they weren't really caught in the act, as it were. Now, let us have a brief discussion, if you don't mind. I know we're not seeing these animals at the moment, but I've been burning with desire to talk about this with all of you. Many of you are loyal viewers. You've been watching a long time. And for those of you who aren't, well, I'll give you a brief background to what's been going on. Karula, the great queen of Juma, 12 years old, pushing 13 in March, actually, so she's only 3 months shy of her 13th birthday, had some babies, two youngsters, on the 2nd of February, Khosana and Shongile, their names, one male, one female, in that order. And they are now obviously, well, almost 11 months old. And she has been seen mating again with Tingana, the male leopard. Now, that, well, we're all quite surprised. Normally, it only happens once the cubs have gone independent. Normally, they go independent probably around 14 or 15 months for the female and a little bit later for the male, but they do start to spend extended periods away from the mother from about this time. So that's the background to the story. Now, for those of you who have been watching regularly, you also know that Karula's first daughter, Shadow, has done the same sort of thing, but to the detriment, we think, possibly, of the, I think it's 8 litters of cubs that she has lost. So she's never raised a youngster to independence, as we know. And so last time she had a baby, she was seen mating when the cub was about 10 months old. Well, that was two litters ago. And then this time round, when the cub was only 4 months old, she came into estrus again, or came into heat, and began mating again. And we think, therefore, that she then neglected the baby and the baby probably died. Now, that is quite possibly a hormonal imbalance. But the big thing to say here, of course, is that a lot of what we say is wild supposition out here. And as Brent likes to say quite often, the animals very seldom read the textbooks that we read, and therefore they act completely against them very often. And so it's important that, of course, when we are proved wrong and we see are seen to be talking utter nonsense, that we acknowledge that and move on and come up with a new theory. So I am slightly on the verge of saying maybe I've been wrong about Shadow, because Shadow, of course, has been mating long before her babies have been independent. It's not necessarily the major reason that she's lost them, but it's so interesting that Karula has come into estrus very clearly. It's a proper full estrus, I think, simply because, you know, they've been mating for 2 or 3 days now. That sounds like a proper estrus, not an anestrus. Now, there are various reasons being put forward by Brent for this, because he's the one who's been watching them. One, quite a good reason, I think, maybe she's trying to draw him away from those cubs, and so she's come into a proto or anestrus. I'm not sure about that, simply because, as Brent said yesterday, they have been mating now for 2 or 3 days, so I'm not sure that that's true. But it is also possible that those cubs are going to go independent early. It's not too young for the female, certainly. We know that Hosanna, the male, killed a duiker the other day on his own completely. So they're clearly able to look after themselves. It's going to be fascinating to watch what happens going forward, and I'd love to have your thoughts as to what you think is going on with the great queen and Tingana. Well, this is a great question from James. Do I think that her maternal instincts will return once her oestrus is over? In other words, although she's carrying a new youngster, if she does fall pregnant this time, and remember, it took her 6 bouts of mating the last time for her to get pregnant. So I doubt it's going to happen straight away, but it might. Do I think that even if she does conceive, she will have a return of her maternal instincts and go back to Hosanna and Shongile? I do, actually, yeah. I might be totally wrong, but I do think she will. I think that she will look after them until they become, you know, independent almost of their own accord, which they clearly are doing already. So it's all rather interesting. Ellen, the last time we heard about Cruella's cubs, you worried about them, obviously. We were always a little bit worried about them. 2 days ago, we heard of them on Hoffman's, which is to the south of our traversing area, and yeah, they were fine. Well, in fact, we don't know about Shongile. Hosanna was there, and he had killed a duiker. He's the one I think we should be more worried about, because the males go independent far less readily than the females. Let's just have a look out over this blustery sort of view. You can see the clouds scudding overhead. Right, Brent Leo Smith would like to talk with me on the Graham Drive channel. So while you look at the view, I will talk to him. And go ahead. Okay, copy, thanks. We're on our way. Apparently something has been caught in the drainage line just below the dam wall at Gowrie. So, the Gowrie dam wall. We're going to head there as fast as we can. Vroom, vroom, vroom. Hold on tight, Rion. Take your dentures out. Put on your seat belt. Now apparently some of you have been surprised, of course, to learn that Hosanna has killed a duiker on his own. I was very surprised myself, and of course, with our rehearsals that we've been having and the TV show, you haven't been watching as regularly as normal. And half the time, I don't know whether we've been in rehearsal or in reality, which is, I suppose, the whole point of a rehearsal. But yes, he did kill something on his own. And that was very useful, of course, to him, no doubt, especially given that his mummy seems to be, well, trying to make another family. But like I say, it did take 6 times. She made it with Tingana 6 times before she conceived with Shongile and Hosanna. So, I mean, this is, could be the first of many such incidents. Right, let's find out. Let's go straight across to Brent. Brent has heard something he thinks being caught in the dam wall or just below the dam wall. So let's go and find out from him what he heard.
Okay, well, initially I heard some Impala alarm calling. It's difficult to hear clearly in the rain, in the wind, sorry, not the rain. And then I heard a very weak, like something's just caught a baby Impala. The Impala were alarming heavily in this area, looking up towards the Juma Dam. So we're just gonna check very carefully. I've called James on the radio, so he can also come give us a hand. But as I said, we've got to be really careful in this wind. So we're going very slowly. Could be a leopard, could be a lion, we don't know. Let's make sure there's nothing above us. Stranger things have happened. Now, of course, if it is a leopard, we also don't want to disturb it or chase it off. That's why I'm also going very carefully. But this is really exciting. This is how we normally find a lot of our animals. We hear alarm calls, we get off, we track on foot. So imagine this, you doing this with us live. And we all know Viam likes a cat or two on his walks or drives. Now, after the rain, it's really difficult to see tracks. Now, I can see the impala. They're looking quite relaxed. So it was only the impala that were close by here that were alarming. I'm also listening for the birds. Maybe the birds might give away if there's a leopard tracking on a baby impala. And it's going to be near impossible to see footprints at the moment. So what we are actually just hoping to spot something. Again, this wind, we have to be very careful. See where they're looking? Where they're looking? Now they don't alarm at people. Now there's impala alarming and they almost look like they're looking at us. I don't know if something is just behind this little bush here. With leopards, if you do spot one, you want to pretend that you're not really looking directly at it, because we know which leopard it could be. The impala were looking straight down into these thickets between us. Is here. There's definitely something here. The impala is starting to. Okay, we're right down in the bottom of this little drainage line, and our signal might be a little bit jumpy. So, what we're going to do is we're going to send you across to James while we continue to check through this area very carefully and very quietly.
Right, we're not too far now. In fact, we're right in the area where Brent said he heard the noise, and there's a massive herd of impala. They're all looking this way. They look utterly terrified, out of their wits. Why? I'm going to just look around here on the ground. Maybe one of their number has met an end at the teeth and claws of one of those mating leopards. Perfect hunting conditions, these, for a leopard. Let's go a little bit forward. Or any predator, for that matter. It's blustery and cold. They're looking into this block here. Let's look up into the trees. They're not alarm calling at the moment, which tells me... There, now they are. Something's in here. Shouting. They started running. Let's see if there isn't something coming down through this area. There's a game path here. Maybe a leopard. Maybe a lion. Alright, we're going to have to be very patient here. I don't know why those impala were shouting. It did sound like an alarm call, but the males have been chasing the females. But they were definitely looking into this area. Let's just stick our noses in there and see if we don't come up with anything. This is fascinating, very exciting stuff indeed. I wonder also where Brent is, because in a bluster like this, if he was close by, he would have been perfectly able to get the kind of position of the noise of death. But if blustery weather like this, if he was quite far, well, you could easily make a mistake. Right, I don't think she can be far, or he, or whatever it is, can be far from where we are now. This is exactly where the impala were looking. Let's keep going up through here. I'm not seeing anything at the moment. Well, this was obvious, obviously, because I'd be leaping about with joy if we'd managed to find a leopard or a lion. Something dying. Impala do have very good eyes, so, I mean, it might not necessarily have been close by that they were looking. So we're on a game path now that heads straight towards the dam. We'll ease our way down through here. There's a steenbok. Look at it. This little guy. He's panicked. Can you see him there, Rian? Just straight through there. Oh, you can't see him. He's just behind the bush there. Anyway, that's him there. We won't hang around there. We'll carry on. He's no doubt absolutely terrified. Please excuse the bumping. This is, of course, Strychnos madagascarensis, possibly the world's most offensive tree. I'm just going to update the game drive. Yeah, if we had a big herd of impala looking east, at least west into the block there, the alarm called once and then ran. I've checked the block on that big game path that heads towards Gari Cutline, no, at least heads towards the dam now, but I haven't come up with anything. Now, Brent Leo Smith, everybody, is just up ahead in front of me. Right, Leo Smith says maybe a little bit further north. We'll just go and get a quick update from him. He's right in front of us here. There he is, with Wium and Herberto. This is very exciting. Will be much more exciting when we find whatever it is. Hello, what have you seen? Scorpions. Yes, I know you've seen scorpions, but what I'm getting at is, what do you think is going on here?
Leopard somewhere.
Where?
I don't know.
You think you heard death there?
We heard, but this wind, it's so hard, so we heard snort, 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 and then snort, 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 and then we came down, and the impala were looking.
Yeah,
this
in there.
Snorting, and I mean, we've walked through the drainage line, and there's no tracks.
So what do you think? Did you hear them alarming again?
Yeah, I did. I heard them alarming, but I heard you as well. You were with them when they were alarmed.
Yeah.
I've got a feeling it's still in there.
Okay, so we're going to drive down that way then.
We're going to go to the dam wall and then start and check the southern side or the western side.
All right.
Bye.
Good luck. Ja, Wium. All right, let's look down through here. Those guys reckon that whatever it is still in this block here. I must confess that I think that makes the most sense. Because the impala were looking this way. But it's so windy, you can hear the wind howling. Feels like we're in Cape Town. Well, without the sea, of course, and the overabundance of people on holiday at this time of year. Right, Taylor apparently has got a Christmas surprise going on. She's on Arethusa.
So it seems as though holding on and driving around Arethusa is actually paying off. Watch out, Brian, and hopefully we're going to find out soon. Now, let's have a look and see what's happening here. Everybody, you're going to have to duck those. We go underneath these branches. Ooh, under we go. You okay there, Brian? Okay, it's not a big one with lots of thorns. We've got a big aerial sticking out. If perhaps you've just started watching, well then, you won't know really what's going on here. Now, I'm going to show you. We're going to get a view now, Brian. The leopard is just over there. Can you see just by those logs? But we're just waiting for another vehicle to very quickly reposition, and then we're going to sneak in and see if we can have a little view. Ooh, this leopard is tucked away so nicely. Oh, we're going to see. We're going to go forward. Thank you very much. Well done. One of the Arethusa guides managed to find this leopardess. Let's see if we can get a view here. Oh, it's a tough one, Brian. That's a hard one, hey? Let's see what we're going to get from this angle. Now, who are you, madam? Now, of course, you know, I'm still learning all the leopards on the property. There are a couple that I haven't seen. And I'm not sure who this is. The guy that was just in the sighting said that it was perhaps Tandy. I've never seen Tandy before, but we're just going to have to wait and see what's about to happen. And maybe you can help me. And if perhaps you know who this is, I'd absolutely love to know. And you can do so by hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Let's have a look. Come on, girl, lift your head up for us. Now, if it is Tandy, I'm going to be so excited. Like I said, I haven't seen her, and I've been absolutely dying to have a look at the second daughter of Karula. We've seen Shadow quite often. We saw her the other day with me, and then we saw with Brent, and I don't know when last we've seen Tandy, so I hope that this is her. And if you're wondering what on earth she is doing that's preventing us from having a look, there we go. Who are you? Now you can see that she's grooming herself so nicely. Wonderful. I've just got a little whisper in my ear from Louise, and she says that this is indeed Tandy. So if any of you had guessed right or passed on the comments that this was Tandy, thank you so much for all your help. But now I'm going to need a little bit more information. I'd like to know a little bit more about this beautiful leopard. And I'm sure one thing on your mind as we sit here looking at her grooming herself, you're probably wondering, where on earth is her cub? Now, the last thing that I heard, and this is, I haven't really heard any new developments, so I could be behind. I have just been on a long holiday. Is that, unfortunately, she lost her male cub, and she was left with her daughter. Now, I'm not sure if her daughter is still around, or if, unfortunately, she has lost her too. But like I said, if you've got any interesting information... Oh, sorry, Louise, I'm struggling to hear what you are saying to me. We're in a very difficult section. Oh, maybe it is. I know a couple of you are saying possibly it could be shadow. Let's see, she's got three on the right side of her face. If she's got four on the left side, and with that pink nose, is a giveaway. Let's see, come on girl, let's see if you've got that four spots on the left-hand side of your face. Maybe it is shadow. It wouldn't surprise me because we've been seeing her hanging around in this area a couple of days ago. Remember Brink found her? And that was just a little bit north though, closer to the boundary between Arethusa and Juma. I think it could be her. I don't think Tandy's got a pink nose. I mean, that pink nose is very unique and it doesn't look like a young leopard either. She looks slightly older. She's got a couple of tears in her ears, a couple of scars and things. Come on, girl, let's see the other side of her face. So that'll be exciting if it is shadow. Maybe we'll be able to get a nice look at her. And then I'll have to update it on the radio as well. But having a good afternoon, groom. And when she was found walking along the road. We must have just missed her. Brian and I were searching in this area, but we didn't check this road. But we checked another road, probably about 200 meters away from this beautiful girl. Hello, beautiful. I'm so happy to see a leopard this afternoon. There we go, there's another opportunity. 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you see that? Four spots on the left-hand side of her face. So well done. That is, and you are all correct if you said that this is shadow. And I always have to thank you. Thank you so much for always helping out and with the identification of leopards. For some reason, this is something that doesn't happen overnight. And it takes a bit of time and practice. But now this is the third time that I've seen shadow. So hopefully the next time I won't mistake her. I think I was actually so exciting and hoping that it was going to be Tandy. And now I know I can't really comment on what she looks like just yet because she's sitting down and I can't see her tummy. So we'll hopefully we'll have a look and see what her body is looking like. Maybe she is pregnant. Because if she's got a full belly again, remember we saw her, I think it was almost a week ago, we saw her sitting on top of the termite mound and she did look like she had a big belly. But she didn't stand up for us, which made it obviously quite difficult to really tell. And then we saw her with Brent and she was bulging. And if that is the case again today, I think I'm going to agree and say that there are a couple of little cubs inside that belly of hers, but we'll have to wait to sort of really be able to answer that question. Hello, girl. Isn't this lovely, though? Never did I think on such a windy day would we be so lucky to see this beautiful leopardess. Any cats really in this horrible weather, with it being so windy. I thought that they would all be tucked away under some shrubs. Well, sort of like Shadow's doing at the moment. I don't think we would have seen her if she wasn't walking on the road. I think if she was tucked away like this, everybody would have just driven around until she got on the move again. Hey girl, you're settling in for the day. We're actually also not too far from where we saw those vultures. As the crow flies, we're maybe a mile, if even that. So maybe she did catch something, and that's what the vultures were feeding off. Remember I said it was in the drainage line, there were lots of timberti trees and jackalberries growing up there, which made it quite difficult to have a look in there. So maybe she was there and abandoned whatever it was, or ate as much as she could, and well then the vultures ate the rest. Now I'd love to hear from all of you if anyone does have any questions. Well, like I said, I'm still waiting to hear some interesting little tips. You can hashtag SafariLive. Do that. Sorry, hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, and of course questions@wildearth.tv. Now, Mario, you said that these animals need name tags. Wouldn't that be wonderful It would make our lives a lot easier, but of course it takes the fun out of it. But yes, that would be nice, especially when you first come into an area like this and you're trying to learn about the different individuals or predators, or the leopards, the lions, the hyenas. And that's something I'd actually, I'm quite interested to see. So we've never really had a permanent, or everywhere else I've worked, there was never really a consistent den site for hyenas. So they'd come and go, they'd only be there for a little while, and then they would move off. And obviously that's because of the high density of leopards and lions that were in the southern sector at the time. The hyenas never stayed at their dens for too long. And I never got an opportunity to be able to sit and really look at the key identifying features of a hyena. Now that's going to be an interesting one to learn, because I know that the hyenas are big characters. Hello, beautiful. There we go, looking at us. So I'm going to need a lot of help with that, and I've got my notebook armed and ready. So the next time that we see some, it'll be nice to hear a little bit about them. We did have one big hyena that hung around the lodge when we got to know, but that was really all. She had a bit of a limp, so she was easy to tell the difference between the others. Now she keeps looking around her. She's not sort of just grooming herself. And I suppose that's quite common with the leopards. When you see lions grooming themselves, they don't really pay attention. Sorry, just having a distorted message from Lou. Now this is the problem out here in the wilderness. Oh, thanks. Sorry, Louise. So I'm just getting the tail ends of Lou's messages as she sends them through. Remember, we are in Africa, of course, and well, sometimes they have little dark holes out here and the gremlins hop on and it prevents us from communicating, sometimes with you and sometimes, of course, with the lovely ladies in Final Control. Now, Emery, you were saying that it's very easy to identify Shadow because of that pink nose, and you're quite right. I was so excited to see this leopard as we pulled into the sighting. I completely overlooked at such an obvious key identifying feature. Here she goes. Now we're going to have to keep up with her. And it's just us. There's nobody really coming to the sighting. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn around very quickly so we can keep up. Let's go. And I hope you're ready. Luckily it's not too thick just yet. We've got a little bit of an open clearing. Oh, there we go. That's quite nice. She stopped to pose beautifully out in the open. Oh, so we can see there's a... She's got a bit of a bulge on her belly. What we'll do is let's go around. Sorry, I'm jumping around here because I want to catch up to her. And we're going to see if we can zoom in nicely to have a look and see if there are perhaps any suckle marks or anything that will give us an idea, maybe even some swollen teats, just to see perhaps, well, if she has got little cubs in the oven, or maybe she's already had some cubs. We'll find out now, hopefully. Whoops, sorry, Brian. Didn't mean to do that. And likely it wasn't a thorn tree, I suppose, eh? Here we go. I think we'll get a nice view now. I'm going to try and jump up ahead of her so that we have a bit of an advantage and can watch her coming towards us. She's actually scanning around. I must say, she doesn't look as fat as she did the last time I saw her. Oh, no. She's not. She's sitting again. Shadow. So that's the first thing that I noticed. The last time that she was seen was with Brent. And she had a massive tummy. So I suspect that there may have been something that she'd obviously eaten that was inside there that was bulging like that. But she still looks big. And we can only speculate at the moment until we get a proper look at her mammary glands. Thank you so much, Ellen. Ellen, you said that she has a neat V notch, and I think I actually spotted that on the left-hand side of her ear, so I'll make a note of that. That's a fantastic feature. Let's see if we can see anything. Come on, girl, just stand still for just 2 seconds in the middle of the road. I can't see anything obvious just yet on her stomach. I'm just having a look to see if I can see the mammary gland. Ooh, they look swollen. Do you see that? They look very swollen. She's moving too quickly to have a look, though, to see if there is a suckle mark. I'm going to try and keep up with her. So we'll just have to carry on and maybe we get a better look, but definitely some milk inside of those mammary glands. So that's exciting. So I think I'm going to be quite happy and say that there's definitely a couple of cubs. Whether they've been born yet, I'm not sure. We'll just have to wait and see. Wouldn't it be amazing if she did lead us to her cubs if she has had them? Oh, that would be so exciting. That would make my whole year. That would be the highlight for 2016. Now you can see she's paused up on this fallen log, scanning the area. Perhaps she's going on the prowl. And myself and Brian, I can tell you, well, we can both tell you that there's been no shortage of impala on today's drive. So I suspect that she's hopefully going to go and look for some of those. And I'm just bringing my GPS out because I want to make sure that we're not going to... Oh, she's going to the boundary. Let's hope she doesn't go too far. I'm going to make sure I don't go driving off onto someone else's property. I think we can make it through this gap. Well, we will try. Are you ready, Brian? This is not a scary one, though. Hopefully she sits up on this termite mound. This will be nice if she does that. And I'm looking around to see if there are any impala so we don't disturb them. You see, she's looking left, she's looking right. And up she goes. Look how she's trotting up to the termite mound. Have you seen something, girl? Looks like her brain is working overtime. Just driving slowly to get around, see what she's looking at. Now remember, her eyes are also much better than what you and ours are. No, now she's sitting down and facing the other way. Brian, should we just do another loop? We're just doing the scenic way around. I'm showing you the whole termite mound. This will be very, very nice. Hello, beautiful girl. And she's such a lovely leopard. She is so patient. Well, every time I've seen her, she's been patient and so obliging. Oh my goodness, we're almost looking eye level into Shadow's eyes. It's not a very big termite mound either. This is amazing. Hello, girl. It's really not every day that you get to sort of be at the same level as a big cat. So when you see something like this, it's so special. And I wish you were all here with me on the back of the vehicle experiencing this. I'm just very quickly, while we're sitting here, going to update the sighting on the radio. I just need to work out where we are. Let's turn the volume up. Mobile's Mufazi Ingwe static. She's up on a termite mound. We are basically between Buff Skull North and Southern Fork. You should get my visual from the Ndlela. It looks like it's Shadow. It's just one unlock. Hello, girl. I love the way that she glances over at us occasionally. It almost feels like she's looking straight into the lens. And like I said, I just want to very quickly recap, because I know there's so many new people who are starting to watch the show, so welcome to all of you. So you probably heard me going on about the spot pattern on this leopard. Now, if you're wondering what a spot pattern is, it's something that we use to identify the various leopards. Now, I know some of you have heard this, and you know the spot patterns of the leopards better than I, but we always need to keep recapping and updating everybody who's just starting to watch for the first time. And it's always nice if you can give them a helping hand. So, if you've just started watching, We'll see if she keeps her head still, but you can see on the left side of her face, there's a row of very neat dots above, sort of the in line with her nose. But then if you go down to just before her whiskers start, you should see that there are four little spots, one quite close to her nose, then another splotch to the right, and up above that is a third spot, and then just down below that third spot is a fourth spot. And then you look on the left, on the same place, you can see she's only got a row of three spots. And we put that into a ratio. So we read left from right, so she would have a spot pattern of four, and then, of course, the ratio symbol, and then three. So that's an easy way. But there's other ways that you can identify leopards. Like Ellen said, on the left-hand side of her ear, her left, of course, she has a very neat V nicked out of it. And then, of course, something quite unusual, her pink nose. Normally at about two and a half years old, that pink on their nose starts to fade away and it eventually turns to black. But I've also seen a pink nose on other leopards before, but sometimes it's when they get older. But I think Shadow is a special girl and she's had this her entire life. And it seems as though she's not playing ball with us this afternoon about showing us her mammary glands. But that's fine. That's what keeps it interesting. Is that what is she going to do next? Is she looking for something to eat? Has she had cubs? We can't see any. I didn't see any suckle marks. The very quick little slot we got. But maybe you managed to take a screenshot and got a better view than of what I did. Maybe there were suckle marks. We'll just have to wait and see. And I'm sure you're all jumping for joy, though. This is very, very exciting. And it's a tough topic to talk about because we know that Shadow is not, unfortunately, not the best of the mothers. But that's just how it goes out in the wilderness. Is that it's like in humans as well. Everybody's got their talents, and it's just very unfortunate that Shadow doesn't seem to be very good at raising her offspring. But maybe this round, maybe this time we get lucky. Now, speaking about all these beautiful little cubs that, well, could potentially see, Roger, you were wondering what is the gestation period for a leopard? It's quite short, actually, and that's why usually with the big cats it comes as a surprise when one of these animals is pregnant. So the gestation period is about 3 months, not very long. And it's normally only in the last sort of couple of weeks that you start to see the real swelling of the mammary glands. Oh, what's flying in the distance? Are those storks? Sorry, I got... Oh, hello. Hello, woolly-necked storks. Off they go. That was quite nice, Brian. It was beautiful. The two of them flying around on this windy day. It must be quite difficult, of course. Isn't that nice? Just sitting here watching a leopard and then two woolly-necked storks fly by. That was fantastic. It's my ooh butterfly syndrome, of course, jumping in. Only I could get distracted by birds as we're sitting and watching a beautiful leopard. So I do apologize, but here she is. She's back again. And we'll try and stay with her for as long as we can. It would be nice to follow her and see what she gets up to. The markings on her face is quite beautiful. No, what is it? So it almost looks like her eyes have been weeping just a little bit. You can see that in the corner of the eyes, which is normal. But the way that it's almost been rubbed, that dirt that's sort of weeping, all the mucus and stuff that's weeping from the eye, when she looks away, it almost looks like she's got the tear marks of a cheetah, don't you think? Obviously, you have to use your imagination when I say this. But those black markings come all the way down, almost to where her whiskers start. Now, thank you so much for sending in all your screenshots. They're beautiful, and I can't wait to have a look at them a little bit later. But we're going to head back now across to Brent. But don't worry, we're going to stick with Madam Shadow.
Now,
now the wind is howling. I'm here with Mildred the millipede on the edge of quarantine. Mildred's just milling about as millipedes do. It has been an absolutely fantastic time with you all on the bushwalk, and we got to see something we don't see very often, and that was that olivaceous scorpion with all the babies. I guess they're probably about 25 or 30 babies on her back. Wasn't that amazing? She can, well, certain scorpion species can have up to 100 babies at a time. I didn't think that olivaceous had that many. Also, when they are little like that, they actually don't feed. So they, ooh, I'm getting caught on my own tree. They just are staying on their mother's back while their exoskeletons are still soft and they're still vulnerable. And in about, depending on the species, between 10 and 20 days, they'll ride on the back of the mother before their carapaces harden and they go off in search of whatever they want to eat, and they will be able to be very proficient hunters from a very young age. And scorpions, like not many other arachnids, are also born live, so it is a quite an interesting thing. Well, Mildred's moving off, we're doing the same. It's the wind still really strong, it's getting a little bit dark, and VM Herbie and myself do not want to be tomorrow morning's lion feces. We'd prefer to be tomorrow morning's lion trackers. So it has been wonderful, and thanks again for joining us on our little bushwalk. And we are going to now head back home before we become tomorrow morning's lion dung. And luckily enough, Taylor is still with the incredible Shadow, so let's go back to her and that wonderful cat.
I really hope that Brent makes it home safely, though I'm not too worried about Brent. I think he can fend for himself out in the wild. Oh, she's so, a couple of branches sneaking in. Look how she's posed herself beautifully on this very old marula tree. Hi, girl. Oh, that is so beautiful. That is picture perfect. Look at how well they can balance. And of course, that's absolutely nothing compared to when they climb to the tops of the trees and balance on the thinnest of branches. Now, I suppose it is a good time for this leopard to be out, even though I said it is quite windy, and often we see the lions tucking themselves away, and some of you see the leopards doing the same thing, but it's also good hunting weather. And remember, we saw those impala earlier, and we saw them running around, running away. This is what she wants. Ooh. Now we're doing a little bit of off-roading over some old logs. Now, as we drive along here, I apologize if I don't pay too much attention to you. I need to keep Brian safe and not let him get whacked by any more trees. One's enough, hey, Brian?
Yeah,
that's
enough.
One's enough? Luckily, Brian's a good sport about it. So, James, you were saying that if Shadow hasn't given birth just yet, which I don't know if she has. I couldn't see any suckle marks. Sorry, I'm just checking the boundary again that we don't go into Simbambili by mistake. Now, you said that, and I quite agree with your statement, is that if she does give birth, she's going to go elusive for a bit, which is quite true. And, well, we probably won't see her for a while. Now, I 100% agree with you. And it is nice that we got to see her today. I'm just double checking. Ooh, we're getting close to the boundary now. Hopefully she just carries on going a little bit further south, because if she carries on going west, it's going to get a bit tricky. And we may sadly lose her, but we'll try and stick to her to the very end. It's so close. Gee, Brian, did you see that? How good was that?
Yeah.
That was skill driving then. I better not say that and then get myself into some trouble. She's such a patient leopard. Oh, sorry, girl, I didn't mean to do that. Little stumpy over here. I don't know where to go, Brian. We have to go over this one. Up we go. Just pass the branch back to Brian. Come on, where is a lovely herd of impala? Now, I'm of course going to root for the leopard in this case. And the reason being is that if Shadow does... Oh, look at this, look at this. Oh my goodness, she's just jumped up onto the top of this, again, a fallen marula tree. That is the most perfect spot to have a look and see, well, if we're going to find anything. This is so beautiful. Now, I hope you, I'm not even, I'm hoping, I hope you are, you better all be taking screenshots. Because as common as it is, or as people think it is, for leopards to climb trees, it's not often that you get them doing a pose like this. Now, of course, I wish we were on the other side, but maybe she glances back towards us and gives you all an opportunity. This is lovely. Must be quite daunting as we're going up a fallen tree like this marula. And it looks old. It looks like it's almost completely rotten. The termites have been hard at work. So I'd be nervous to go on a branch that's higher up than that, as I think it might snap with the weight of her. Not that she's particularly heavy. She's not a massive leopard. Medium size or average size for a female, I think. So she probably weighs about anywhere between maybe 50 and 60 kilograms. So what's that? About 120 pounds or so? Somewhere around there, but look how gracefully she came down. Should we have a little zoom and see if we can see any suckle marks? Oof. Now, it was so difficult there to get it, try and have a look if she's got suckle marks. She seems to be quite fluffed up, maybe because of the change in temperature. It's hot, it's cold 1 minute, then it changes again. So it's very, very difficult to see have a look at the mammary glands. Just watch out here, Brian, as we just tuck through this tree. Off she goes. Now, Roger, you were wondering if leopards, and female leopards of course, will chase away their young before or after they've had a new set of cubs. Now, it's actually quite interesting. I've seen both things. So I've seen it before where a leopard had sort of told her older daughter to keep, you know, to sort of move on. But she had new cubs, and I saw quite a bit of interaction between her and her two cubs, her new cubs, and then the older daughter from her previous litter. Okay, so she sat down. Let's try go around. And then I've also seen it, where, like what Karula's doing now, mating with Tingana, but she's got two cubs that are 10 months old. I've seen the same thing with another leopard down in the south, same thing. At about 10 months, she dropped her little one, young male, and said, right, cheerio, off you go, and she left him. She didn't want to have anything to do with it. And he lived. He survived. Here we go, a nice open gap. Now, sorry, I can just hear the radio going. I just want to update the sighting once again, and then I'll get back to this conversation. Just want to make sure that in case there is anybody wanting to come here. The mobiles, there's still one mobile unlock with Shadow. We are just sort of south of Shigordi Pan. Here we go. Update done. To let all the other rangers know what's going on. But we're spoiled. It's just us here. Nobody else. But maybe they... Oh, that's where they are. I forgot to tell you. I forgot to mention the update about the lions, about the Nkuhumas. They are very happily, and it seems as though the whole pride is together, on Simbambili, but quite close to the boundary of Arethusa. So they might come back, hopefully by tomorrow. But it sounded like they were on a buffalo kill. Unfortunately, I didn't get the update or not whether they were, if it was a big buffalo, if it was a calf, how much they'd eaten. I didn't hear that. So we'll just have to keep coming back to Arethusa and checking and having a look. And, well, it's paying off over the last few days. Oh, no. That obviously means I must stop. Hey, Brian. And that one. Oh my goodness, I'm getting myself wedged between a rock and a hard place at the moment. So before I get myself into any more trouble, let's go back across to James, who's got the sweetest little thing out in the bush at the moment.
Well, they're certainly, if they aren't the sweetest little things, they are certainly close to the sweetest little things. Hundreds, literally, well, probably not quite, maybe tens of beautiful little impala lambs with their mums. They've just been doing their late afternoon exercise, making their way up towards quarantine clearings, which is off to the west of where they're now sitting. And that's because it's clear there. There's a nasty wind blowing. Very easy for the predators, and we still haven't found what caused Brent to think that something had died around here. Definitely, as we arrived, there was great alarm calling from various animals, but we've really not managed to find anything. I went off on foot, I looked around the place, I saw through the bushes the colour that you're looking at now of impala strewn across the ground, and I thought, oh my goodness, there is a dead thing. And then we drove in there to see what had killed it, and it wasn't a dead thing. Well, it was, but it was a piece of dead wood. And so it wasn't anything that had died recently. Now, we're not only sitting here with baboons, we're also sitting here with some nyalas, who are coming from the right-hand side. And there they are. And not only that, there is also a troop of baboons not too far from here. We'll go and have a look at them shortly. Very nice. Let's go and just see if we can't get a look at those baboons. They are clearly very aware that Vuyatela is unoccupied by guests this afternoon. That's the camp there. And so they seem to be taking up residence. One of them is about to pop over the fence into the camp. They were just feeding down in the drainage line here. There we are. We'll just pull up here and we can have a look. There they go. Unfortunately, they have taken fright. Now, we are some distance from them. Why they should have taken fright, I cannot imagine. Look at the little one. Isn't that sweet? They really are quite special creatures. And I'm sad we don't see more of them. And I hope that they spend a bit more time with us, because, of course, the more time they spend with us, the increasingly likely it is that they will habituate and realize that we are in no shape, way or form a threat. Marvelous. Okay, let's carry on and see what else we can find. It really has got nastily blustery out here. I don't think it's going to be very warm for very long. I might even have to put on a jacket. But we nearly put the roofs on before we went out today, and something about the complete inaccuracy of just about every single weather report I've ever read about this area made me think, I don't think it's going to rain. It may still do a few drops and spits, but I don't think there's going to be much. We were told, guys, batten down the hatches. At least 180 millimetres coming your way. 180 millimetres, everybody, is, it's about, I can tell you exactly what it is, 10 inches of rain. 10 inches, they said, in 24 hours. Then it went down to less than half an inch, and now we stare at nothing but driving wind and the odd spit from the sky. So I don't know. We clearly understand the weather about as well as we understand the world's economics. Right, let's continue down here and see if we aren't very lucky to find whatever it is that Brent heard. Now, Akarula the leopard, of course, she was around here yesterday. Maybe it's her that's killed something. She might be very hungry after the exertions of the past few days. And I'd still be very interested to hear from all of you why it is you think that she's mating already. Let's just have a quick look at those flowers up there, for no other reason that I haven't pointed them out to you this season yet. Those are, of course, the flowers of the weeping wattle, Peltophorum africanum. And it also gives you an idea of how extremely hard the wind is blowing. Cat in Tampa, I'm going to say no, I don't think so. You say, could the drought have affected Karula's cycle? Cat, I would say no, I don't think so. It's not impossible. Nothing's impossible out here. I mean, if we can't even get the weather right, well, we just certainly don't understand fully the variables at play in a leopard's life. I just don't really see what the connection would be. Maybe a slight difference in nutrients could change a hormonal balance, but I don't think so. You know, she's been eating so well, and as Brent pointed out when we were having that fireside chat about the strangeness of white muscle disease and why the leopards didn't get it, he pointed out very, very nicely that leopards, of course, have a much more varied diet than lions, and therefore they probably didn't suffer the same effect. So I don't think that would have caused a hormonal change. I mean, look, the drought was bad, but it was by no means, we tend to, we love to use the expression in living memory, which to my mind is quite meaningless, but we love to say this, and I do it myself a lot, this is the hottest season in living memory. This is the driest drought in living memory, because it sounds very dramatic. We had a drought. Was it the worst this area has ever experienced? I don't know. There is a very nice Wahlberg's eagle up there. It certainly was pretty bad, but I don't think that would have affected the leopard's estrus cycle. I think perhaps the suggestion that it is her age, Brent made that suggestion, is possible. It's possible that she's getting old now, and so things are getting a little out of whack. But, no, I don't know, maybe her cubs are just more independent. Who knows? Right, yes, so you're in Finland, and you say, can we stay on the bird, please, Rion, if you don't mind? It's better looking than I am, frankly. Right, you say you reckon that, yes, her age could possibly be playing a role, but you don't see a connection with Shadow's estrus cycle. The reason I mentioned Shadow was just because we know that she does come into estrus, well, the last two times she's had cubs, very early on. And I wondered if there wasn't some connection there. I don't know if that's got anything to do with it or not. But it's all, we need to sort of, almost, it's almost like a puzzle, you know. You've got to lay all the pieces out on a table and figure out how they all fit together. And of course, if you don't have the picture from which to build the puzzle, well, which we don't, it's quite difficult and very entertaining indeed. That is a Wahlberg's eagle. The Wahlberg's eagle, of course, is now hanging on for dear life. If it lets go of its perch now, it's going to end up in southern Zimbabwe within about 25 seconds. There is a driving wind. It's spotted something it wants to eat. Ooh. Ooh. What have you spotted, bird? That's quite interesting, isn't it? And you can hear some thunder rolling in now, maybe. Let's see if it flies. No. I mean, this really is not nice weather for an eagle to be flying in. It is a beautiful bird, isn't it? A lovely bird. Now, Stephanie, you ask a very good question as we zoom into that eagle. You say, how do you tell the difference between a hawk, an eagle, and a kite? Stephanie, it's not actually as simple an answer as you might think it is. We have given birds sort of common names or generic names based on our experience with them. Very strictly speaking, an eagle is what you're looking at now. It's one of a few genuses of birds that are closely related to each other. They're feathered all the way down to the bottom of their legs, and often this one used to belong to the genus Aquila. It doesn't anymore. And so they keep changing the taxonomy. But the most notable feature is that they have feathered all the way down to their legs. A hawk in this part of the world is often something that belongs to the genus Accipiter. So it would be the goshawks and possibly the sparrowhawks. But it can include, of course, any bird that catches another bird or its prey in the air. To hawk something means to catch prey in the air. And so it can be used to just describe the accipiters, and I'll show you a picture of them just now, but it can also be used to describe any bird that catches prey in the air, so that's a bit difficult. Kites, well, there are two different kinds of kites out here. We get the Milvus kites, which belong to the genus Milvus. Then you get the black-shouldered kite. Why is the black-shouldered kite called the black-shouldered kite? Well, it's got black shoulders, but why it's called a kite, I'm not really sure. So it's really quite difficult, and you know, a lot of what we call birds has to do with what we, certainly before we got all taxonomic and scientific about it, what we used to call them. So I'll just have a look at you. I won't have a look at you at all. I can't see you through the lens. I will show you some of the raptors here that we have. So if we were to sort of split things up a bit, in fact, let's put this on the dashboard. I think it'll be a bit easier. We've got the Milvus kites. That's the yellow billed and the black kite. Those are those ones here. I think come to the pictures, Rion. That's those ones there. Then we've got the snake eagles. We've got four species of them, but they've included the Batalea in amongst the snake eagles. It's sort of closely related, but not massively so. Then we have the true eagles, and it says they're distinguished from all other raptors by fully feathered legs. And we've got lots of different kinds of them, and they're all in different, Aquila is the Latin name basically for eagle, and they're all the Aquilas are considered true eagles, and so are all of these ones. But then you get the fish eagle, which is not feathered all the way down to its legs, but it is still considered by some to be a true eagle. So that's quite interesting, and it's all quite difficult. Then we go across the buzzards, and the buzzards belong to, normally in this country anyway, and this is a nice example, Buteo. That's the genus they belong to. But of course a buzzard in the United States basically refers to something like a vulture. So that's quite interesting. And then I'll just quickly show you the accipiters. These are the accipiters here. The sparrowhawks, the goshawks. And then of course, if we move on from there, you get the harriers. And then you get the falcons, which are my favorite raptors. So Stephanie, in a roundabout way, I've probably just left you utterly confused and bemused and none the wiser. But that's because I'm not really much the wiser myself. And it's got lots to do with the biology of the animals rather than our common English usage for the names. I hope that makes some kind of sense. Righty, let's move on. We're going to do another loop around this block. We're going to go down into the Umluamati drainage, and then we'll come up Vulture's Nest Road that side. Beastly weather now, beastly. Ugh. I'm assuming Leo Smith has closed down and gone home by now, and so it's just Taylor and I out here, and she is going to try and get a decent look at shadow again before she crosses completely. There's the other Wahlberg's eagle just flown over us. Well spotted there. But I do not see the telltale spots of a cat. We'll just keep going down here and hopefully we'll be very lucky. Ooh, foul weather. And Janet, much the same as we were discussing a little bit earlier on today, you say, do I think when Karula's finished mating, she will join up with her cubs again? I do, yeah, I do think that's going to happen. But they are, I mean, already starting to spend a little bit less time with each other. And, I mean, I've said this from the beginning, and I've been pilloried for it on a few platforms. I've said from the beginning, you know, those leopards, they play a little bit. But they have never, ever shown the kind of social cohesion that a lion pride does. And that's totally normal. It comes from their desire eventually to live alone and be without the others. And I've noticed more and more of late that they have been spending increasing amounts of time alone. Especially as Hosane gets bigger, he becomes a pain to have around for his sister, you know, because he will basically start to bully her off kills. And for a long time, she did the bullying when they were the same size. He's now much bigger than she is. And so he will make things a little bit difficult for her when it comes to finding food to eat. I must say, not a great deal of mammal life other than that that is standing out in the clearings now, waiting for things to unfold as the night progresses. Terrifying time of the day if you happen to be a Nyala or an Impala. There's a woodland kingfisher there. Well, Feline Ferocity appears to have some kind of telepathic connection to Karula, and you say, Feline Ferocity, she's a smart cat. She's realized that the two cubs are going independent and then they'll be fine, and therefore she has in some way managed to sort of bring on Estrus. Feline Ferocity, there might be an element of that, yeah. There could be an element that the cubs have gone independent quite early or are in the process of it, and her physiology therefore is switched, and she's now, yeah, producing the hormones of estrus. That is possible. I just think it's so early, don't you? I mean, it really is very, very early for a leopard to be going independent. And you can see the light is fading horribly now. Christy, you're in North Carolina and you think that, you reckon Karula maybe just needed some lovin' after looking after those cubs for so long. Well, that's possible, Chrissy, but look, one doesn't talk about these things when one is referring to royalty, of course, does one? But yes, I take your point. It's a rather spectacular woodland kingfisher. Just cleaning his or her beak. We don't know if that's a male or a female, of course. They look identical. Not to each other, I've no doubt, but to us. Isn't that nice? And if you were ever in a situation where you're confused about whether that is a mangrove kingfisher or a woodland kingfisher, well, there is the reason. You can see that it has a black lower mandible. In other words, the bottom half of its beak is black. The top half is red. I do rather wish it would come out from behind that stick, but that's interesting the way it's sitting. Isn't a young bird. It's certainly not a completely immature bird. No, it can't be. The young birds have got red both top and bottom. I forgot about that. Beautiful. So, I love having this discussion about Karula and what's going on with her. So, any further theories, which may or may not be true, let's have them. It'll be great to hear from you and what you think of them. And why it is that our leopards are perhaps behaving slightly strangely. That woodland kingfisher doesn't seem to be behaving strangely in the slightest, so let's push on from it. As the darkness starts to fade, I might have to turn some lights on. Might even have to use a spotlight. Perish the thought. All right, Taylor is still with Shadow. I think she grabbed her by the tail and brought her back over the Simbambili boundary, so that's great. Let's go and find out how that went for her.
She doesn't look like she's going anywhere for the moment. She came up onto the termite mound and, well, she turned around and plonked herself back down. And I think she's got a very good spot. I think the angle that the wind is coming from, we're sitting downwind of Shadow, I think that hump on the termite mound is blocking it out. So she's probably having a lovely peaceful sleep and also, I'm sure, enjoying the nice cool evening that we are having today. Isn't this lovely? We probably won't stay here for too much longer. There are a couple of other guards that are probably going to come into the sighting. We will most likely give them an opportunity in the next couple of minutes. We don't have to race on out. And hopefully she doesn't just rest here. Hopefully she's had her nap now for the last couple of minutes. And I haven't seen anything coming closer. I've been scanning around, looking to see if there's any of the big herds of impala, which we've been seeing throughout the day, or any common dacre or steenbok. But it seems as though there's nothing at the moment. So Shadow, my dear, I think you're going to have to head into sort of thicker vegetation in order to find a snack. Because out here it looks a bit miserable. And not really anything for you. She's got a perfect pillow, too. The perfect hump on the termite mound that just fits the shape of her head quite nicely. That looks very cozy. And no chorus tonight. No birds that were shouting away. And as I say that, I can hear the babblers shouting in the distance. They're the only ones that are saying goodnight. The rest of the birds, I think, took the day off and went into their hidey holes a little bit earlier, which I don't blame them for. Fast asleep. Not a worry in the world at the moment. But still listening. I love the way that ear, those ears sort of twitch. And I think that's an unbelievable talent to have. Imagine if you could just sort of sleep and, well, listen to everything. And I know you get different people. Some are light sleepers, some are heavy sleepers. I used to be a light sleeper. I used to be a little bit like a leopard and a lion, I suppose. I'd hear the door creak from down the passage, or I'd hear somebody go to get some water in the middle of the evening and open up the refrigerator, and I'd wake up to those types of sounds. But as I've gotten older, not that I'm very old. I always say this, and people turn and look at me and they say, Taylor, you're 24 years old. What are you talking about? And I suppose, well, everybody gives me grief about being so little. But I'll get big one day. And now, well, now I don't hear too much at all, actually. The occasional elephant that's breaking the branches outside my window, we hear that. Or when VM's shelf collapses on itself, the whole of camp hears that. But it's nice not to hear all the creaks in the night. Otherwise, can you imagine? You just never get any sleep out here. Imagine waking up every time a lion roared. Out here, when the Nkuhuma's on the property, you'd be waking up every half an hour. You'd never sleep. Or an owl hooting, anything really. The hyenas whooping. Of course, or the soaring sound of a leopard, because they come quite close to the camp too. So I'm glad that my sleeping patterns have changed slightly and I'm not such a light sleeper. But I think we're going to have to say goodbye to Shadow now and give everybody else a turn to have a look at her. They've been so kind to us. No one has been here for the entire time. And I suppose on their way back before the safari ends, it wouldn't it be nice? And I'm sure if you were all out here on safari, you would love a special treat of having a dose of a leopard just before you went back for dinner. Bye-bye, girl. I hope you have a wonderful evening, and I hope you catch something tonight after your slumber. But I think let's get rolling. Let's head out. Right. Thank you so much, Shadow. It was beautiful. I'm so glad we got to see a cat. While I try and make my way out of this tricky patch, let's go back across to James.
Isn't that a rather fun way to come back to me, everybody, on an ident? I wonder what that means. Anyway, I think it's quite a nice little sort of transition from all the way on Arethusa to here on Juma, where there is still nothing but blustering wind, the odd spit from the sky, and not a great deal else. Also, some string from my jacket, which is tickling my ear and driving me mad. Now, we've come onto, as I said, Vulture's Nest Road. To give you an idea of where we were, we've driven due south from the Wahlberg's Eagle's Nest. There's two massive birds going on here. I think it's highly unlikely we're going to see the first one again. It was a Marshall Eagle. I wonder if that isn't a juvenile Marshall Eagle there. Well spotted. I'm afraid I couldn't begin to tell you what that one was. Well done, Rion. Nice tracking there. What was I saying? I was waffling on about something of vital importance to the world. Oh yes, so we went south from the Wahlberg's Eagle's Nest, we crossed the Mulwati drainage line, and we're basically now going north again. So we're doing a loop around the block where Brent thought he heard the death. There are two doves. And the two doves are waiting for the night in a romantic sort of position there. Look at them. Hello. Chap's going out to dinner tonight. Or staying in. Staying in? Well, that's fair enough. It is Friday there. You should feel free to go out. Not sure what you'd eat on a night like this, though. You might be eaten. Possibly best to stay home. Yes? Good. Okay. Well, we'll carry on. We'll see if we can't find a leopard. And I must just make one more mention, of course, of the expected deluge. Now, there was a great deal of credence given to some form of weather prediction that La Niña was going to give way to El Niño, and as a result of that we were going to have a massive, massive amount of rain. And so all the landowners around here have buttressed their dams and made sure that they're all full. Well, not all full, that the dam walls are, the integrity is maintained, they've got much bigger. You've been on Cheetah Plains, they've created basically a water park at one end of the place. I'm of course being very facetious. And we've had, well, pretty much average rain so far. I may well be forced to eat my words, because if we do get floods, it normally comes sort of late December and into January. But so far, the predicted deluge and Noah-like activities of the landowners of the Sabi Sand have been, all for naught at this stage. I'm surprised I didn't see one of them building an ark. There's a little bit of thunder every now and again. Unfortunately, there is no leopard at this stage. I keep driving over this caked clay and it goes, sounds like lightning overhead. But I don't think there's any lightning overhead. Fascinating about Shadow, of course, as well, that she too seems to be about to give birth. Let's hope that as she heads into her, well, not quite dotage, she's in her prime really, but as she comes to the business end of her prime years, that perhaps this time round, she manages to maintain the integrity of her parenthood. I'm not sure that that's a valid sort of phrase, but I'm going to go with it anyway. There's some flowers over there, Rion, that I'm going to try and retrieve. Unfortunately, they are a creeper called a jasminium growing in a Sisyphus bush, and we all know, of course, that a Sisyphus bush is most likely to do me quite a lot of harm if I get too close to it. I'll go around the other side of the Sisyphus bush, all the while keeping my eyes firmly peeled for creatures of the night or the day. No, I'm going to be completely unable to retrieve a flower, I'm afraid. Oh well, you can see them there. And they, of course, are called a jasminium because they smell like... Everybody together? One, two, three. Jasmine. Well done. I knew you would get that right. And jasmine, of course, one of those super sweet, wonderful smells. And it certainly takes me back to my childhood and my very first touch of the wilderness. And as we can see absolutely nothing at all, I will tell you that story if you would like to hear it. Oh, you would like to hear it. Good. Excellent. I'll tell it to you then. I remember as a young lad, my parents used to take me. Some of you would have heard this before, of course, but you may have forgotten it with any luck. When I was a young boy, my parents used to take me off to the Drakensberg with my brother and my sister every year in August, just as the winter was starting to come to an end. And we went to a place called The Cavern, which is a marvelous place just in the northern parts of the Drakensberg Mountains, or the northern Natal Drakensberg Mountains, so quite a long way south of where we are now. And on the wall of this ancient building, it had been a farmhouse and then converted to a guest house and slowly expanded until it was this wonderful sort of family-orientated place where people used to go and climb the mountains and ride horses and play tennis and, well, I suppose the adults probably drank a couple of gin and tonics and that sort of thing. Anyway, on the wall, the old stone wall of the main building there, there was a giant creeper. And the giant creeper was a jasmine plant. And I remember so distinctly, and every time I smell jasmine now, it takes me back to that place. I remember so distinctly that being the very first sort of wildish flower, other than my mother's roses, which of course were not wild at all, that I remember thinking, God, that is really just the most wonderful smell, and thinking, that's a little touch of nature there. And that was before I had any kind of notion of what wilderness is, or what effect it would have on me later on in my life. So that was the first kind of touch. And then rather the same time, when I was a young buck of 17 years old, roughly 3'4" in height and weighing in at about 10 pounds, I did a week-long job stint at that very place. And on my last day there, I went up and I climbed to a ridge through a forest, and I looked down east over this amazing valley. And there, in Natal, the grass grows very long, and there's a particular species of grass called Hyperinia hirta, or the red thatching grass, and it grows very long. By the time August comes along, it's sort of overhead height in many areas, and people, especially the Zulu people of that area, go and harvest it and use it to thatch their homes. And I remember watching down the valley and seeing the waving stalks or culms of that Hyperinia hirta, the red thatching grass. And I remember the dust in the air, and also, of course, and I've said this many times, the sound of the silence. And that was the very first time that I believe I was touched truly by the wilderness. Ooh, Monique in London, I'm not sure what kind of lilac you're referring to. You say jasmine and lilacs are your best flowers. And do I know, or do we get like a bush lilac. I am clueless as to what your lilac looks like, I'm afraid, Monique. The only thing that I can think of possibly that's close-ish to that would might be a... what are you clicking at, man? Oh, a bird. A roller. Well spotted. Rion, good job. Monique, the only thing I can think of is an African violet, which we do get here. Does that look anything like a lilac? We're starting to get the odd bit of precipitation now. All right, let's keep going. That's a lilac-breasted roller in the dark, so therefore it is a silhouette of a lilac-breasted roller. And we're back into the area where I went off on foot to find what Leo Smith had said he thought was death. So maybe we'll find something here. Hello, Dingo. You say the cloud must be quite thick to induce darkness before the sun has gone down because it's still light where you are in Pretoria. Well, Dingo, yes, the cloud is thick. That is absolutely correct. But at the same time, Dingo, we are a lot further east than you are in Pretoria and Johannesburg, and that means it does get dark here a good, I'd say 15 or 20 minutes before it gets dark there. So if it's clear in Johannesburg and Pretoria, you will find, I guess, at this time of the year, as we head towards the summer solstice on the 22nd of December, you'll find, Dinga, that, yeah, I mean, it's going to be light where you are until about 20 past 7, I suppose, and then, I mean, if you go down to Cape Town or you go down to where my parents live in the Eastern Cape, it'll stay light till around 8, half past 8 in Cape Town if you're very lucky. So that's how that works. And that's just because of the position of where we are. But yes, the cloud is thick and it's certainly making it darker than it would be. All right, I'm a little bit worried about the rain, so I'm going to just pack things away here a bit carefully. Taylor is on her way back from Arethusa. Let's go and find out if it's spitting where she is.
Over the northern section of the Sabi sand. It's starting to pitter-patter down now.
Coming back to us. We're live. We're live. Hello. Sorry, Rion. Rion's just trying to put the rain cover on everybody. And sorry you lost picture with Taylor there. Rion, do you think we need the rain cover? I think we'll probably be all right. Let's hold it off just for now. If it starts to get really nasty, then we'll put it back. I'm going to put the cover on my bits and bobs. There we are. Okay. If it does get nasty, everyone, I'm afraid Rion will definitely have to put the cover on because we do not want, of all the things to get wet on this vehicle, the camera is the one that we want to get wet the least. Let us continue. We're going to go back across the dam wall and up onto quarantine and see what we can find there. Interestingly, this was the one dam that was not made bigger. The spillways were fixed, which was nice. And this is the main dam, of course, of Juma. Oh, that is a beastly wind blowing in from the left-hand side. Now, normally out here, of course, it doesn't rain very hard when there is wind like this. It's as the wind drops that the water starts to heave out of the sky. It's looking very ominous to the south. It's starting to thunder a bit. We'll just go up onto the clearings here and have a look, and then I think we may well have to put the rain cover on, I'm afraid. We'll just also find out where Taylor is, and because she'll be getting closer to home, I'm sure. Tracy in New York, very good question from you. You say, do we ever think about doing a night broadcast or a night walk? Tracy, we do, and we have. The thing about nighttime is that unless you have action going on, here are some impala suckling, I'm actually going to just keep moving slightly. Okay, Rion, you can put the cover on now if you want. I'll just keep yakking away. Tracy, the night time, as you can see now, of course, things are getting dark. Unless you've got a highly sophisticated sort of military grade high, what we call high ISO camera, which is the camera that's able to see at night with a picture that's still acceptable in color, it's really pretty unpleasant because you can't see anything unless it's happening right in front of you. So for example, we did our Mara trip in September and we had infrared lights everywhere, and it was extremely exciting when the action was happening actually in front of us. But you can't pan off to a view or look at the clouds going over or spot a bird here or spot a bird there. So it's fantastic when there's action on the go, but it really is not particularly fantastic otherwise. So yes, it serves a purpose completely if you're going to follow lions on the hunt, which is what we did in the Mara. Now, the reason we don't do it full time is that it can be a little dull, simply because it's difficult to see what's going on. Obviously it is, it's nighttime. Then, the other thing about operating at night on foot, that's an interesting one, that becomes dangerous because you can't see what's going on, and on foot at night gives animals or gives the predators a hugely, they get confident when they're running around at night time, and so it's just a little bit dangerous for us to be walking around at night. I have, however, Tracy, done one night walk, and we did it with guests at Londolozi, and we did it at full moon, only at full moon, in an open clearing, and we had a car drive through the area beforehand and was not too far in front of us, just a couple hundred meters or so. It was a profound experience. It was really beautifully done. I was kind of the backup guide, and the chap who led it made it a whole kind of spiritual experience. And he read a poem to everyone. No, he didn't read it, he recited it. Very wonderful ability to do that just before we went out. And then we went out and we sat on a rock afterwards for a long time, and I played the guitar quietly, and we had some delicious hot chocolate. That animal is alarm calling. But Tracy, you don't do that all the time. It really can be very dangerous indeed. There's one impala ram there, alarming. That seems is disco lights on my face. I'm not sure why that's happening. But there are a whole lot more in the direction that he's looking completely relaxed and happy. I suppose I should put some lights on. So I don't know what his problem is. Let's keep going onto the clearings here. And see what we can see. Not a great deal at this stage. Blustery night, not expecting a great plethora of activity. All right, the force is strong with Taylor at the moment, and therefore she can give us an update.
I'm back. Apologies for that as I disappeared. Arethusa's gremlins are tough out there. Now, I was starting to tell you a story, but I've forgotten what story I was about to tell you, so I will tell you another one. Now, I know I started telling you about the lions, and Brian, I didn't really give an update, did I, about the lions? And then Shadow distracted me. So, apparently the Nkuhumas are on Simbambili, and not too far from the Arethusa boundary. I think I did say this. So it'll be maybe a good idea tomorrow. Hopefully we don't have too much of a downpour tonight. Well, in the morning. And go and have a look down that boundary road, that cut line between the two properties, and see if they haven't indeed come across. Now, I'm looking for any little bugs as we're driving along Gowrie Main. So I'm just aiming my light onto the ground. We know that they like to come across the road at this time of the night as well. Some of the creatures that are more nocturnal than they are diurnal. But let's see if we can spot anybody. Brian, what insect do you think we're going to find? A two-spotted beetle. That's a good guess because we see so many of them. What else? Maybe a scorpion or a shongololo. That would be a nice one. Let's go off here. Then let's jump on this road and try our luck over here. But it's a bit chilly tonight. So Brian was saying that we need to find a chameleon. However, I think it could be too cold for the chameleons. And I, by the looks of it, I'm wondering if it's not going to be too cold for the insects this evening as well. Oh, which is a little bit disappointing. Oh, what was that? Oh, I've got something. Let me jump on out. Oh, I don't know. I forgot how to open the door for a moment. I'm not having a very good day today. Been very accident prone. I'm still covered in bruises and scratches and scars and all types of things. That hasn't disappeared. Hello, Shongololo. Up you come. Don't. Was wanting to fight and go into the ball, into its defensive ball, but luckily, it's a fast one. Hey? Oh, no, don't do that. No, don't. No. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, Shongololo. Please don't release your terrible, foul-smelling, horrible stuff. Sorry, I'm moving around quite a bit, but I don't want to get that terrible concoction that has a cyanide in it over me because it does not smell very well. Oh, it looks. Is that a mite? Can you see if there's a mite running around on it? It might be a bit difficult, but I could see something moving around the inside of those coils. Yes, you can. I think if you're looking right in the middle over here, it looked like there's something actually moving around. Maybe it was its antenna. There you go. And it's waking up again. And off it goes. No, careful. Don't be too brave. Now, can you believe that millipedes have been around for a very, very, very long time? They were one of the first invertebrates to walk the earth. And can you believe that the close relatives of these millipedes that we see today were almost 6 feet in length? And you think that would be amazing to see a giant Shongololo? I think it would be so spectacular. No, don't fall down. No, don't worry. And I'm not going to eat you. I really don't want to eat you. Amanda's cooking us a wonderful dinner tonight. So you're not on the menu just yet. Okay, let me pop it back. Come back, Shongololo. Here you go. Put him on the ground. Now, you be careful out there, because I don't want you to get squashed. Here we go. Off it goes. And well, thank you to the Shongololo for cooperating and not get off me stick. And well, not defecating all over my hand. That would have been terrible. Well, probably would have provided some entertainment to Brian. I'm sure he would have had a good giggle. Right. Make sure the Shongololo hasn't gone under the car. Right, hasn't gone under the car. That's good news for us. Come on, chameleon. Ooh, was that lightning? Ooh, that's not good. There's a flash of lightning over the top of us. But I think it's still a little bit far away. Let's see what other little critters we can find lurking on the ground. Or perhaps lurking in the trees. Oh, I'm just going to dim everything, as we are going to be passing some impala and also a wildebeest, which is standing somewhere over here. You can't see it. It may look like I'm patting him on the head, but I'm not really. But off they go. Good night. Have a wonderful evening. Stay safe out there. Right, lights back on. Right, let's go here. Oh, another Shongololo. That was always one of the funniest things when driving around with guests, is that I really do try not to squash anything. So you'll often see me focusing just on the road in front of us, as well as scanning around. But it's so important. So maybe I'd forget to tell my guests, you know, that I'm always cautious and I try to avoid the little things on the road. So I'd be driving along, now Brian, are you holding on? And I'd be driving, looking over my shoulder, talking. And well, the next minute, what I'd do is I'd be driving like this. Let me go over this little donga though. And then you'd just see me go, wah! And then I'd be back on the road and then carry on talking like I'd done absolutely nothing. And you'd see the panicked faces on my guests as they grab the bar in front of them with white knuckles holding on because they've got this crazy person who looks like she's incapable of driving. And then obviously I explained myself and they understood why I used to swerve around on the roads all the time, avoiding all the little bugs. Now, I believe there are a couple of you that are hoping to see an aardvark tonight. A nutter farmer in particular is wondering if we could try and see an aardvark tonight. Now, that's something I haven't found yet. I haven't found an active aardvark burrow. I'm still looking to find one, and then it will give you a good indication of where to check. And well, I suppose that's the joy of doing bushwalks, is that you are on the ground and you are able to find these things. Now, I've told this story many times, but I was lucky to find an aardvark burrow quite close to the lodge I was previously working at, and we regularly saw this big male. He was beautiful, and like I said, we slowly started to habituate him. He started to get more and more relaxed when we saw him, and the sightings with him went from 10 seconds to about 2 or 3 minutes, which is quite a long time to have a look at an aardvark for. Quite elusive, but maybe with this boom of all the alates and termites that we've been having, hopefully that's going to draw a lot of the little creatures out. So things like the jennets, the African civets, maybe we're going to start to see a few more of them around. But I still haven't found a large fungus growing termite mound that's exploded. That's really quite impressive when you can see something. Oh, another Shongololo on the road. I'm just aiming this one light right down here on the ground where I can see a little bit better. It doesn't look like a hitter. Now, as we're driving around, avoiding all the millipedes that we possibly can, Heron was wondering what eats millipedes. So there are quite a few different things. I suppose you could say the main predator of a millipede is probably the birds. So we see hornbills eating them. We see a variety of different birds. But there's also a mammal that loves to feed on millipedes. And that mammal is an African civet. So often when you see their little middens on the ground, and maybe we'll try and look for one tomorrow morning, you always see the exoskeleton of the millipede. So that's quite nice. So Heron, I hope you watch what it'll be in the afternoon for you. So I hope you watch the afternoon show, and we'll try and find a little midden so we can have a look and have a further investigation. Remember, scorpions like to eat them too, so there's so many different things out here in the wilderness that loves to eat the millipedes. Not me though, not Brian and I, we prefer other types of food. But it has been absolutely wonderful. I have to dim my lights again. There's a big herd of impala, and we've just got a couple of minutes left of the show, but I hope you've had a good evening. It was fantastic that Shadow popped up and we can monitor her for a little bit longer. But for myself and Brian, have a wonderful day, and I hope it's sunny and warm and you just have a fantastic time. So the thumb's saying cheers too, and we'll catch you on the Sunrise Safari. Let's go back to James.
Well, yes, sunny and warm it might be, but you know, we might get the predicted deluge, finally. Hundreds of inches of rain cascading out of grey, black skies, filling the dams to capacity. Well, maybe. We might also have blinding sun, of course. Right, we have a few minutes left to find some form of night animal. There's a moth. There it is. Excellent shot. Well done. We've got a moth, everybody. Fantastic nightlife going on here. Rain's starting to fall a bit now. Yes, Safari Dean, you're absolutely correct. I'm so glad you've noticed that. You say, am I the best spotlighter in the game? Yes, almost indubitably. I think I am the best spotlighter in the game. I am, of course, being completely sarcastic. I'm relatively poor with the spotlight. I'm not sure who the best is. Jamie, of course, has the most distinctive style of spotlighting. This may or may not be the best way of spotting things. Anyway, it's now starting to rain. So I'm going to drive at some speed towards home. We won't be putting the rain covers out at this stage of the game. We have 1 minute left, everybody. Birds are holding on to their perches. Hatches are being battened. impala ewes are holding their babies close. Right, I'm not going to stop as we stop, everybody, as I say goodbye to you. We're just going to keep going because it is getting a little bit, well, wet. Thank you for coming on our drive with us. I'm so pleased that Taylor managed to find a leopard for you, because I didn't find a great deal at all. I do apologize for that. A big thank you to Rion, his first world premiere. There he is. That's his, diving okay sign. We will see you tomorrow, of course, at 0500 in the morning. Might be sunny, might be rainy, but whatever it is, we'll see you and look forward to it then. Bye-bye.